Hello everyone, welcome back to another episode of Die Party Iron Saddle, your weekly brush with God, I guess. God, I'm sorry. It's 2 a.m. Get off my back. So this is a Die Party Iron Saddle is the Stars of That Number. Stars of That Number game. We're in week number, what, 4, 5, 7, 12?
17, man. Where have you been?
Yeah, seriously.
17. Okay. Hell yeah.
We're about to conquer the galaxy.
Nice. Actually, what week is it? 4! You guys lied to me. It's 4. Anyway, hey everyone. Sorry for the shitty intro, but bad. let me go around introduce everyone who we playing today. First up, we have my good friend and master of disguise, Mr. Eric Valgaris. How you doing, sir?
Hey, what's up, Henley? What's up, chat? What's up, my fellow players? This is Eric, your best friend, your sometimes lover. I'm a Twitch streamer. I focus mostly on role-playing game content. But so every so often, I jump into the realm of FPS games, bringing along Henley. We like to deliver sandwiches. Looking forward to that when BF1 drops again. Getting a World War One on, a lot of fun.
Oh so, yeah. Did you see all the fucking data mining they did for BF1?
No. Yo. Oh yeah, all the stuff they released.
Game modes.
Yeah, man.
Fuck yeah.
Yeah, dude. Super excited for it. So I just recently started up a new game called Torchbearer, the Oathkeeper's Domain. It's a game set in sort of like Firewatch, like Wyoming-y kind of game, like fantasy stuff. Expect a little bit of like West Marches and like high desert mountain kind of cool stuff. And players are pirates. It's really cool. It's on Sundays at 4 p.m.
Wow, so. You just said like... I sort of like looked at that and thought, man, he's making a YouTube video right now and he's hitting those key phrases as hard as he can. Wyoming, Firewatch, Desert, Pirates.
Hitting tags, man.
I'm pretty good at SEO stuff.
Yeah.
What's up?
Sorry.
What's up?
The SEO on Fleek.
Yeah.
Speaking about being on Fleek, let's head over to Retzi Reva.
I love you, Henley. We all love Henley. You didn't have to whisper it. I'm Retzi. I stream over on Twitch. I harass people on Twitter a lot about stupid things. And I don't know. I usually play survival alpha, infinite alphas. And a couple of indie platformers here and there. Once in a while, a card game or two, and sometimes creative streams. Are you okay?
I never heard the term infinite alphas before,
Alpha. Yeah, it's the infinite alpha running simulator 20. You name X. it.
Oh my god,
forever
alpha.
So that's exactly what those games are because they never get
basically. So if it gets to beta, I stop playing it.
It's over.
I've gotten my hours out of it.
Yeah. How many hours you put into this alpha? Oh, about 200. Beta rolls out, and the game's not what it used to be. You know?
I'm out. It's dead.
Yeah, like you've changed it so much since pre-alpha development. I can't anymore.
What's the latest hotness?
Functions too well.
Yeah, what's the latest hotness world of...
Only play poorly functioning games.
Yeah.
What's the latest hotness in the world of survival games right now?
I kind of picked the forest back up. Rust got a pretty nice graphical update. Looks a little bit like Middle Earth now. And I don't know. There's that new Scorched Earth that all the kids on Twitch are playing these days that I don't want to pay for yet. But yeah, so...
Yeah.
Rust is too polished now for you.
Hey, Jim, can
it's getting there?
Pull your mic down a smidgen? Because we can barely hear what you're saying.
Me?
No, Jim.
Oh, okay. It's like...
Jamal.
Jamwise Gamgee.
I'm sorry, man. I don't know why I'm making fun. I love you. I don't know what I'm doing. I'm just going to fucking mute myself. I'm sorry.
Eric the Bully Valgaris.
Yep.
Can I just say one more thing, though? I'm really sorry. so sorry, dude. You guys ought to play this game called Reigns. It's fucking incredible.
I downloaded that.
Reigns?
It's fucking...
Oh, is that that fucking Reigns card game?
Yeah, it's a fucking card game. It's like playing Crusader Kings or Game of Thrones Tinder, and all you have to do is answer swipe left or swipe right, and it's just, and you have to survive as long as possible before you get like usurped or you run out of money, and then like your kid will take the throne, and it just keeps building this game on and on. You'll get a really good time out of it. It's really good.
Yeah, I downloaded that today. I'm gonna try it out.
Look that up right now.
Yeah, you can actually get it on the phone too, which is like...
Oh, probably, it's a Devolver Digital game. Good.
Devolver Digital. So, you know, like, fucking... Speaking about, let's go over to fucking Solfang, my bro from another hoe. What's up, dude?
Hey, man. There's a lot of hoes in this world. I don't know which hoe you talk about.
The other hoe, obviously. How you doing, hoe man?
Hoe number 348.
Oh, sweet. Thanks for inviting me to the show again. I love doing this show with you guys. It's really fun. I'm Solfang, everybody. I stream on Twitch. Been doing it 3 years in a row. I'm my fourth year now, so woo! I do D&D campaigns on the weekends, and I play a variety of games. And recently, I pulled a dumb. I streamed... It basically took 3 hours for me to put a chair together. I'm sorry, but IKEA is some shit. It's like a Rubik's Cube. Trying to do with my ass.
But did you get? Was it like a challenge stream where you're like, I'm not going to read the instructions?
he didn't read it.
I did. It was terrible.
Instructions are for chumps.
Yeah, I had to use my mouth to fix it. That's how I did it.
Was it one of those?
Is usually a good problem solver.
Wait, so hang on, you had to use your mouth?
I use part of. I sometimes use my mouth on it. Don't ask.
What sort of fucking?
There's one part where I had to screw something in. I'm like, I can't reach it, so I was like, I had to turn the little thing. I'm like it's working, guys. And I was all like, what the fuck is he doing? Once he was there, I was like...
It was beautiful.
Anywho, that's about it. Hey. I'm Scumbag, by the way. I play Marcus Graveheart. Scumbag McCree. Hey.
Well, what was your first tagline that just made me... Oh, yeah. It's Hi, Punani. And I'm just like...
It's Hi, Punani.
Damn it. Anyways.
I saw your face. You were like...
this guy. All right, speaking about this guy and this guy's internet, let's head on over to Tuxi McDimeris.
Hey, hey. Hey,
I'm girl. This guy, also that guy. I'm here to play your resident naive, young, supple psychic man.
Weren't you also Chris Pratt? Actually, you're all fucking Chris Pratt, aren't you? I'm pretty sure everyone is Chris Pratt.
Maybe.
No, ain't no goddamn Chris Pratt. I'm original.
I think someone else is Chris Pratt. yeah.
I was the OG CP.
You still doing masks? What's up, man?
No, masks is done because of life and things. Basically, it all fell apart. That's okay.
Things fell apart. The landmark novel by Chinua Achebe. Yeah. And,
Life happens. It's cool. I have other stuff that I want to do, but I'm probably going to wait a little bit and get it all worked out, and then I'll do more stuff. Mm-hmm. So keep an eye out for that. If you want to, you can go check me out on the places at Tuxedomus.
I think the real reason we're not seeing Mass anymore is because a certain game crushed the shit out of you. No? So, in case anyone was wondering what that was, we literally had hey guys, who wants to join my superhero game? And Tux is like, hey guys, who wants to join my superhero game? When are they?
Exactly. Like, you know, it'd be fun. Superheroes.
shit. And we're like, what if we join forces? And you're like, no. You're DC, I'm Marvel. that's essentially what happened there. We won though.
Yeah.
We got the movie rights, we got the Netflix deals, you know.
Yeah, we went the way of Laserdisc. And Fulcrum's DVD.
Yeah. Well, no, we're Blu-ray now.
Yeah, but Maximum Power's done. I'll be doing more stuff, and I'm still doing a bunch of stuff on other people's channels like this. Iron Saddle, which is super cool. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I'm really looking forward to tonight. We get to explore Alien Planet.
That's it. Yeah, me too. It's going to be a lot of fun. So, quick announcements from my side. We recently just got a sponsorship deal from New Retrowave, which is fucking awesome.
Really?
Yeah. It's going to be that's going to be fucking awesome. New Retrowave is fucking dope. Like, normally I'm like, you know how you see people like, yeah, I got it from fucking SteelSeries, you know, they send me mice and stuff, and I'm like, oh, fuck that. I don't want any of that shit. I don't, like, if I'm gonna work together with a company, it's because I have to love their shit. I have to love their shit super bad. So they're gonna be, like, the official soundtrack now for Night City, which is fucking incredibly dope.
Dude, fucking congratulations.
Yeah, seriously, that is awesome. Yeah,
I'm having some, like a serious fanboy moment.
Yeah.
Bad girl, whatever you want to call it.
Holy shit.
All I listen to.
Yeah. The other thing is, too, we started a brand new series. It's called Board Games with Bearded Bros. it's literally just the dumbest thing. I spent 2 hours, 4 hours ago, literally pretending to be a cat wizard because that's the rules of the board game that we were playing. It was a nightmare. And you should definitely go check out that shit. Yeah, we play with Peachy Pixel and Sheepdog Gaming, and that shit's gonna be great. That's gonna be a fantastic new show. That's on Wednesdays. But anyway, other than that, let's get into the shit.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, alright.
Yeah.
So last time on Die Party Iron Saddle, we had a bunch of cool shit happen. And when I mean cool shit, I mean, like, finally we managed to get all of y'all motherfuckers in the game so that we could continue. It took a while to do that, but everyone finally showed up and we were able to progress with the story. We had a Lamprey lock or a pirate boarding from the Segoi, which is like an ant-like race. And they forcefully boarded party's ship after they accidentally fell out of hyperspace or whatever the equivalent is called in Star Wars Lamprey. I honestly completely forgot.
Drill space.
Drill space.
Henley, yeah. Speaking of forcefully boarding things, we have Jim with us that didn't get to talk.
Oh no.
What?
Give him a chance.
Oh my god. Jim.
I saw your transition.
Jimmy. Jimmy. Hey. Hey Jim, how you doing?
Well, in the immortal world, words of Pharaoh Little Kitten, I am a strong, independent TTRPG player. I don't need no introduction.
I feel really bad now. All right, thanks, guys, for watching Iron Saddle. This has been a good episode.
Let's try again next week.
Yeah. Professional streamers.
Yeah, chat's mentioning, too, though, Jim, you did get two intros last week, though.
I did?
Yeah.
Oh, right.
Something broke, so Henley introduced you.
Yep. Yes. It's true. Didn't watch the VOD.
You should watch that VOD. So, Jim, how you been? What have you been up to last week?
I fixed my internet, I hope.
How do you fix your own internet? Was it like a...
I have no idea what... I don't have internet problems, but I did last week, and I don't know
why.
Was
it one of those things where you opened up, like, the web server of your router, and you just, like, you clicked a few things, and you're like, I hope this works, and then it, like, works, and you're like, I literally know nothing about this. I opened up a DNS and made a radio button on now, and then shit started working, so I'm not gonna touch it anymore. Like...
It's more like I dug some wires and laid some fiber optic cables and...
Really? You no. were laying...
No. I'm
not hooked up to anything. Don't tell Jim.
Wow. Okay.
No, you could have said yes and we would have believed you.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, you seem like the type of person that would.
Yes, I do need to tighten the screws, apparently.
Tighten up the graphics on level 2.
No, know. I've been applying for jobs. Past week.
Sweet, man.
Working on the damn dissertation.
Hear that, dog. Fucking on that job hunting grind.
Job tree is not fruiting. With jobbies to grow.
They are, but the problem with academic jobs is the fruit takes a really long time to ripen.
Yeah, like what, 10 years?
Something like that. Yeah. I mean, I'm only in my 12th year of college, so...
Yeah!
I got tired after 7 months and said, fuck this shit, let me graduate early, and they did.
I should have tried that. I didn't know you could graduate just by confidence.
it's not confidence.
That's what I've been doing for 12 years.
He rolled really good charisma that day.
Yeah, I'm just like... So I walked into the office one day, and I'm like... If I just finish all the modules, like, in a week, what does that mean? And they're like, well, you don't have to come to classes anymore. And I'm like, I'll see you in a week. And that's how I got my work ethic, guys. Anyway, all right. Eric, Solfang, Ritzy, Tux, Jim... Dave. Okay, we're good. Everyone's good. All right. Good. Yeah, check it. Yeah. All right. Good. Moving on. Fuck me. Jesus Christ. I'm sorry. So last time, alien boarding, we found out that alien booty is real easy to kill. But so is human booty, as it turns out. Some of our players got a little worked. So it was a good, nice introduction to combat within the system. We then flew our way down to it is called Planet Barra.
It's triggering me. I'm just having the Alpha flashbacks.
Yeah, but yeah.
I just start clicking.
Planet Barra in the back-to-verse sector. It's sort of like a hot, dry, humid planet. It's like a tropical planet. And on this tropical planet, there is just aliens galore. It's like a haberdashery. Wow, I never thought I'd use that word. Haberdashery of alien... life and market stalls and all that sort of stuff. Man, that slick like hair back from fucking Solfang just now.
Oh, yeah. Well, thank you.
They managed to do the main objective that they've had for the past 4 episodes, which was deliver a message to the Homo sapiens about the Vlad coming and, you know, being all... having a new sort of terror weapon against them.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
Something we're supposed to do.
Mm-hmm. But that's been done now, and you guys have been given alien dollary dues to go buy some knickknacks, paddywhacks, and bones for your dog. So we
dogs?
Yeah, we arrive at the some sort of intersection where our players are just sort of like, I don't know, you tell me, how engaged is everyone within the whole falling into just the sights and smells and sounds and tastes of an alien world? Like, is this a
150%.
Yeah? Are you guys getting lost in this? Are any of you being stoic and not participating? Like, you tell me.
No, I'm all in. Yeah? I really can't stop touching stuff on all the stalls. Even though I know I'm not supposed to.
No, I mean, you look around and everyone's sort of like grabbing things off stalls and like, you know, if it's like a piece of clothing, they're holding it up against themselves. And if it's like fruit or something, like, you know, people like knocking on it or whatever and putting it up to their heads and shaking it. You know, the marketplace is a very hands-on space, right? There's not a lot of people, there's not a lot of stalls that are stopping people from touching them. I mean, there might be like the occasional like glassware place that, you know, they might stop you from doing it, but for the most part, they're okay with you guys just sort of touching things and smelling things and whatever. Even if it's food, they don't mind you touching it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm on a hunt.
Oh, yeah?
I'm on a hunt for a cup of coffee.
Oh, shit. Man.
I want coffee.
That's yeah. Holy shit. Yeah, no, that's gonna be tough.
Right?
Fuck.
Right?
Wow, yeah. How are we gonna do that, guys?
How are we I mean, I'm willing to help you out. Like, I'm willing to...
All right, now, here we go. So...
I'm obviously not gonna eat shit, but, like, I'm looking for a stimulant drink that would remind me of coffee.
Interesting.
Hopefully, coffee. But,
all right, know, so...
You have I'm saying it's a galactic thing. I'm saying just, like, coffee has a very distinguishing taste to people, and so I'm looking for something like that. And, like, what do people drink that's stimulating?
Mm-hmm.
And if it's something better than coffee, then maybe I end up with that. I don't know. Or like that's the space I want to explore, Henley.
All right. So you do you explain this to? Because you have a couple things.
I bring the doc
William everywhere is with you, and they've also like the Homo sapiens have given you like two handlers, right? They might be there for security. But in the most cases, they're probably there to help you find what you need to find, right? If you can explain what it is that you're after. So, what do you tell William Everywhere that you're after, exactly? Because you need to explain it to someone who's never drunk coffee before. And these aliens might not have even explored what coffee is.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, welcome to role-playing
games.
It
tastes like sipping on the rays of sunshine. It's a splash of cold water when you wake up. It's when you drink it, it feels... I don't know.
Erkin, did you like go away from everybody, or like are we near you when you're asking Willie?
No, or you'll probably hear me being like, "What do you mean you've never heard of coffee?" Jesus, you know.
Yeah, he William Everywhere was sort of, you know, the camera will sort of just like focus on you a little bit, and then he'll like turn and face the two Homo sapiens that are like following you around, and then he'll say
then
something.
I end up...
So the subtitles underneath him will
Quills,
say,
"I love you."
Will say something like, he'll say something like, but down the bottoms it'll say like, one of my humans is requesting a stimulant that will make him aware of sunshine." And the two like Homo sapiens sort of like quizzically look at each other.
It wakes you up, you know. It feels good. What do you call that?
And then
you drink it, you know. Most like, people suck at making it.
And then yeah, William Everett will turn back to them and then go. and the credits will say, requirement must be in liquid form.
Sorry, all we have is Monster sponsored energy drinks on this. Boy, this is so good. This zero calorie Monster diet.
In the year XX30.
It's the best thing in the galaxy.
Yeah. It's Slurm? No.
It's fucking... Nope, all we have is Soylent. Yeah. Soylent sponsored products, everybody.
So one of the Homo sapiens will he'll sort of like start pushing you in a direction after a short conversation.
Pinching
with the other
me?
One. Yeah, pushing you. Like he'll be leading you.
Oh, leading me on. Yeah. Okay. Cool. Everyone else has probably heard me like being like, "What do you mean you never heard coffee?" And then and then leading me on the way.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I
would hope someone else would come along.
Yeah, someone can come along if they want. He's not
gonna. When you mentioned the coffee thing, Marcus would just be over like, "Willie, coffee is something that just keeps you waking." you just don't go to sleep. You just keep going. Especially if you need to go and fight somebody. Like how we fought those ants.
Yeah, that's exactly what I explained to them.
Stimulus. But Marcus is like, no, Willie, you don't understand. He just keeps saying it.
So this gentleman will keep pushing Harkin along if you guys want to follow or you want to stay together. That's completely up to you. But you can
well, Marcus will just take along with Harkin.
Okay, cool. What's everyone else looking for?
All the wrong places.
I think I'm just like, I probably see something colorful and I just go towards it, like probably just, any sort of random stall. I'm just looking around at stuff.
Yeah, so you pick up this this thing. It's about yay big, and it kind of feels like if you folded up like 5 t-shirts, right? It's about that size, like rolled it up into like a log. It's kind of like that. But when you move like this, it like, and move it around, like it doesn't keep the same color and shape. Like if you move it upwards, it's kind of like, imagine if the best way to describe it is if you've ever cut, like in Photoshop, you have like 2 layers, and on one layer it's like a texture that's completely different anywhere you go, but then you move the first layer around and it just kind of like, it just changes texture and color whenever you move it around. And it starts to deform in your hands the longer you hold it, and it starts to like sort of drip around your fingers, and the sort of shopkeeper will sort of grab it off you and then like smush it up, and it'll sort of just like reform slowly back into like the shape of the log. And, it's an avian alien that's the marketplace guy there, and the avian's like,
Chris?
Yes.
Oh,
ooh. And he's like, and then he,
wow.
And he'll show you, like, you could sort of stretch it out and like you can like snap it, and then like the 2 parts of the thing that were snapped would kind of just like start tendriling out to find the other part that it snapped together, and then it'll like reform back into one thing. Yeah, and then he starts to push it on you, like buy it, you know, like sort of thing.
Yeah, like, I take it. I take out. Like, what was the money like that we got again?
It was like hexagon coins, sort of thing.
Uh huh.
Yeah.
I don't know how much is, but here, and I give him like.
So the homo, like the guy like greedily grabs at it, but the homo sapien will sort of stop your hand, and then he'll pull out like 4 smaller ones, and he will take the bigger one, put the 4 smaller ones in your hand. He'll take one of the smaller ones and give it to the guy, and then and there'll be a short conversation, but you know, it's kind of weird because they're speaking their own languages, right?
So I'm just like wide-eyed, just kind of watching them. With money in my hand, like,
yeah, and it's like I just got more money somehow. Guys, if you buy things, they give you more money.
If you buy things, they give you more money. It's crazy.
You've got this, like, it's sort of like basically like magic Play-Doh, essentially. That's kind of what it feels like, and it's like you know, yay big, and you just like, yeah,
sweet, smush it up. Yeah, so like the homo sapien helps me out, and like they finish, and I like, thank you, I put it back in my pocket, then I walk back to the group, like pulling it and like squishing it together. I'm just like playing with it now. I'm like moving it around, and then I like, pull it up, and then I squish it into a thing. I try to shape it into like a person.
It's like Play-Doh.
Yeah, it's weird science Play-Doh. I love it.
So every like you're doing this, and people sort of like just look at you strangely while you're doing it. But anyway, yeah. So what else is people going for here? I know, Retzi, you were after like sundresses or something like that.
Right? I was. So I wandered up, but I don't know. I did wander over and I was looking. There's like a lot of stuff to choose from. Maybe not sundresses. Mm-hmm. I think you guys deserve something more as the ship's crew when I get back, other than sundresses to wear. I'm sure you can match. So I've
wear sundresses, ma'am.
These are like super cowboy gravity wear. Yeah, it's fine.
So the only way I can describe it is kind of like...
All I know is you really didn't like the velour suits that were on the ship, and I genuinely wish for you all to have something else that matches awesomely.
So you've...
Maybe in yellow.
So if you're looking specifically for clothing to fit Homo sapiens, you find a couple of stills pretty easily. And the only way I can describe it is kind of like, if you've ever been to China or Japan, mostly China, and they have like, or actually, you know what? Fuck it. It's not just China and Japan. It's like, have you ever been to like a fucking like street stall or like an op shop or a secondhand store or anything like that? Where they just have like a bunch of clothing just like on a rack. And it's not even organized.
Yeah.
So you tell me what you want to find, and you can basically find it. The style that I would describe here is kind of like if people were to go back in time to cowboy times, and they were wearing things like, you know, Guernseys from their favorite sports teams, and you know, they're just walking around in, like, basketball shoes, and, that you know, maybe there's a guy who has, like, a pair of jeans on, and it kind of looks like something that you'd find in the time, but not really. It, you know, it, the best way to describe it is, you know, Back to the Future when Marty McFly, like, puts on a costume before he goes back to the Wild West, but that costume still looks fucking ridiculous. Yeah. It's a lot like that. Right, you find some stuff that's kind of like the clothing you're used to seeing, but it's also like fluorescent. You know, like,
like, yeah, I'm thinking stuff. There's probably stuff like maybe looks a little bit like as if you took like a high elf and mixed them with like a kind of a Western, like the trench coat, but there's kind of like a.
I was imagining like a lot of really baggy clothing, like a lot of like excessively baggy clothing, and like there's nothing tight. Like the military stuff is like super tight and like body fitting and form fitting, but the fit, like in casual clothing, is like the exact opposite. It's like as roomy as humanly possible, and like they got like, you know, you got your t-shirts, right? So you're wearing a t-shirt, but then they have that like a lot of droop from like a shirt like hanging down there, and you know, that's what I'm sort of imagining when I think of the Homo sapiens, like at least like the regal.
So they're wearing, so something to the effect of like they're wearing like an Under Armour top and then like a kimono.
Yeah, I would say that's pretty close. Yeah.
All right, so they have like a tight fitting thing and then a really loose fitting thing too.
Yeah.
That cool. Seems about right. Okay, just a headcanon kind of thing. Okay.
Retzi's sending pictures of clothing to people. This is how I'm dressing you. Yeah, no, that's pretty spot on. Yep. Assassin's Creed-y type stuff. Yeah, no, yep, you're pretty spot on. Yeah.
I also kind of, by maybe the clothing shop, there seems to be some sort of like small pets or animals.
Or what are you after, like a lizard?
I don't know, I'm just kind of poking around and looking. Something fluffy and cute that is not really comprehensible to me.
I mean, you guys have already bought one pet. I mean, Tux
like literally... a space critter.
Like, Tux... You
know, like, not a lizard, but like fluffy.
Spoiler alert, Tuxerdamus bought an animal.
Yeah!
So, you know...
Holy shit, that putty stuff is an animal?
Yeah. So there's going to be a scene later on when Tux gets bored of whatever he bought, puts it down, and then you just see it crawling on the roof of the ship later on.
Is it a baby animal?
Or it's our Cowboy Bebop Space Lobster episode. Yeah.
Space lobsters.
Wow. We're out of food. Let's eat the thing. Everyone gets super high. Yeah. So, you know, if like, yeah, there are like, there's like a bird with one leg. It kind of looks like a bird with one leg. And it's got like a body that's just literally just a giant ball of like fluff. And then there's like, also like, it's got like two heads. What's that Pokemon called that looks like an emu, but it's got two heads?
Doduo.
Yeah, Doduo. It's kind of like that, except really fluffy and white. And it's tiny, too. It's like you could fit it in a bag. Cool. You don't see a lot of really big animals in this. There's a lot of... Yeah. But, you know, you see a lot of dead ones as well, like, hanging up by their feet. Like, kind of like how you'd see, like, you know, like, dried duck or something like that hanging up sometimes.
Yeah.
It's a little like that. So you imagine this is for eating, but you can get a live one if you want it.
For pet purposes. Yeah. Okay.
It's kind of like space chicken, almost. So
I kind of want one.
Yeah, well, yeah.
But I kind of also want to buy everybody matching clothes.
Yeah, you can do that. I mean, clothing's not super expensive, and to be fair, like, what Tuxedramus bought was pretty expensive. If you were to hand over one of your like little space credit things, you could probably dress yourself for a year without having to wear the same clothing. Like, that's sort of like the breakdown of currency. It's almost like living in Poland.
Yeah.
Money goes a lot further in space than you would imagine. So you were rewarded handsomely for your efforts, essentially. Yeah.
Well, I'm wondering if there's something like these.
Oh, God. More photos of space booty. I think you might be missing a G on the end of that.
Probably.
No, I don't see it.
Your link's broken. The link's broken.
Everything is falling apart.
The line is broken.
Here we go.
Oh.
It says it's not available anymore.
Wow. Just like that, huh? Oh, yeah. Look at that. Huh.
It's a JAPE. It's a JPE.
It's a JPE.
Yes. JAPE.
Yep. But so... You're just booping around.
They don't have any.
looking for, you know, you can find whatever you like. I mean, let your imagination go wild.
Yeah.
So you could just sort of bring back for everyone, just like, I bought everyone clothes. It's like, thanks. You know, like, so Jim, I'm interested in what the doctor's after.
Yes. So I believe, Harkin said he was taking the doctor with him to go get coffee.
If you want, you can go.
That was before I knew we were having some handlers and stuff like that. You don't have to. I'm not forcing you to do this if you don't want to.
No, that's fine. So he's going on this elaborate description of it being this amazing sunshine and everything liquid. And the doc's just like black and bitter.
Black and bitter. So if you three are gone,
my wife.
Damn. So if you guys are going with this handler, we can jump over that story pretty easily. So you guys are like sort of just following this handler through this busy, crowded streets, and the further and further you walk away from like that sort of like it's kind of like a cross section, and that's where like most of the market stalls are. You start getting into actual businesses, right? You know. In the earth, in the ground, like houses that actually do business out of them. And he walks into one, and you walk down like a flight of stairs, and you go through like essentially what's a bead curtain into like this room that's just filled with smoke, kind of like an apothecary. That's sort of what it reminds you of, like if we had to do D&D terms. So there's a lot of herbs, there's a lot of like incense, and there's a lot of
It's cool, dude. You can call it a weed shop. I mean, weed's legal at this point.
Maybe. And the homo sapien will walk over to the person behind the desk and he'll have a conversation. And he'll just sort of look over at you and he'll come back with essentially a little vial about yay big. So we're talking like maybe 20 milligrams of this stuff. He'll show you. It comes with like what is essentially an eyedropper, right? And you just drop one drop into your eye, and I don't know if I'm pretty sure William might have came with you as well.
Yeah, he was translating.
Yeah, so he would he would turn around and say, "Y'all just need to put this in your eye socket, and the stimulation will go directly to the cerebral cortex."
Mr. Everywhere.
Yes, sir.
I know that you're not familiar with our customs.
I don't think anyone is.
Or our particular dietary needs.
I don't think anyone is either.
But coffee is something that goes in the mouth, not the eye.
So he'll turn around and do the whole like, and down the bottom it says, liquid form for ingesting, not inserting into rectum or eyeballs. And the two like homo sapiens will sort of look at each other strangely and they're just like, so he'll get the same stuff, and he'll smear it onto a piece of bread or something like that and hand it to you. And it's like, yeah, as it turns out, you can eat it as well. It doesn't work as well, but you can put it on anything you like. It's flavor.
So, Doc will take the eyedropper, sort of sniff it, and then do a...
In the eye or in the mouth?
In the mouth.
In the mouth? Okay. It smells pretty poignant. It's kind of like, it kind of has that sort of betadine smell. I don't know if you've...
What?
Kind of like, you know how you get like, it's sort of like, it smells like medicine.
Cough syrup?
Yeah, it smells like medicine, you know how you...
Oh, okay.
Yeah, like cough syrup.
Yeah, like a very... It's hard to describe, but I call it the sterile smell. when it smells like sterility. Anyway.
It's like the hospital smell.
Yeah, it's like the hospital smell in the liquid form. You know, like, yeah. It smells like latex gloves, basically.
Okay.
Yeah. You know?
Got it.
Yeah. There we go. That's the perfect way to describe it. So it smells like latex gloves. And when you drop it into the back of your mouth, it kind of feels like an explosion of just like, it's kind of just like, what would be the best way to describe this? I was about to say chewing nicotine, but you guys already do that, so it's not that. It's more like, have you guys ever eaten or tried to eat like a spoonful of the Gatorade powder?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, of course.
I've never done that.
Uh-huh.
It kind of tastes like that. Or like if you get like a if you like put your finger in like Kool-Aid or like any sort of like isotope stuff and just eat the powder.
Hyper concentrated dry powder, yeah.
Yeah, it tastes a lot like that. And I don't know, you tell me, does your planet have anything similar to that just by default? Probably not. I'd imagine, because it's very chemically designed.
Yeah.
But it tastes a lot like that, right? So it's essentially like what you guys would be getting is sort of like a liquid form of like a very diluted version of like, it's kind of like orange juice concentrate, but for energy drinks, essentially.
That sounds revolting. Yeah. The Doc gags a little bit.
Yeah, it would be a taste that you'd not be used to, but It does.
That is
not. No, that's not it at all.
But the response inside, it kind of makes you feel like jittery a little bit, like when you've had too much coffee. And you just like one of these, and you just like, oh, it was almost instantaneous, and okay. You know, you can probably dilute that very easily with actual water, but like, yeah.
So it has the effect of caffeine, but it does not taste like coffee.
Absolutely not. No.
Okay.
It's not worth it.
Yeah. So Doc says, Mr. Everywhere, could you tell your friends that this is not coffee.
He just says not coffee. How do you explain that it's not coffee? Do you say it needs to
I literally just say, Mr. Everywhere, could you explain to your friends that this is not coffee?
So yeah, he explains it's not what you're after, and then they both just, it's like, yeah, they're not really sure what you want.
A black.
I was afraid of that.
Dark. High energy. Liquid beverage.
Look, it comes from beans. These little tiny black things. You smash them up, and you pour water over them, and it turns whatever the water is into magic. I can't explain it.
So he missed everywhere, turns around and goes, and then the subtitles are basically like, must crush plant, dilute with water.
Good enough.
And they is also black. And then they sort of just like look at each other and they're just like, so they start to like get out a mortar and pestle, and they start to like throw like just a bunch of shit in there, and they're just crushing it up, and you know it turns into like a paste more than anything, and then they sort of like finger it and you know lick it, and they just like, and they go back to mixing it together, and then you know they throw in like these little tiny black pellets, and they push them in there, and then like the paste becomes like black. Like, and then they like they hand the black paste over to you, Harkin, and they sort of push it on you. What do you do?
I don't trust these guys anymore. I don't trust them to get it right anymore.
So you don't even try the black paste? Is that what you're saying? I put all this hard work into it, man. Finger the fucking paste.
They're trying. They're trying, right? They're really trying. They really care.
Yeah, right? They want to sell you some shit.
But is there like a guy over on the side writing down like each ingredient that goes into it? Like he's tallying up some sort of a bill. Like he's racked himself up a pretty high tab at this point, sure, with the mixture.
Yeah. Probably. Most likely. It's kind of like when you go into like a therapeutical doctor and they're just like, yes, the rub down on acupuncture will cost you $700, and you're just like, I wish you told me that before I did it. You know,
like, what we don't know is each time they're modifying it, we're getting charged
a consulting fee, right?
Absolutely. Hey, look, entrepreneurs are in space as well, okay? So yeah, if you don't do anything with the paste and you just sort of like brush it off and walk out.
No, obviously I try it because they're really trying, and I appreciate someone who really tries.
So this kind of tastes like, the only way I can describe it is like, it's like a thick soy sauce.
Yeah, it's like soybean paste. Yeah. Yeah, I know. Mm. No, it's, what's the term? I mean, I think it is just called soybean paste. Mm. Use it in like Korean soups a lot.
Yeah.
Oh, so it's probably not good.
No, it's very salty. It's very, very salty.
Yeah. It's not, I mean, not good for coffee, is what I would say. Yeah, okay. Thanks, but no, it's, oh, I'll come back with a sample someday.
Perhaps, Mr. Bondsman, we should try a different proprietor.
Yeah. I don't think there's any gold in these here hills.
Okay, cool. Yeah, so you guys leave and you make your way back. So at this point, when everyone's sort of, you know, booping around and you know, everyone's playing with their stuff, Garrett's like smushing this fucking thing and pulling it apart still, and you know, just rubbing it against his face or whatever, like pushing his, I imagine you make it flat and you push your face in it at one point and you pull it out. Yeah. And it's like, it's got your face mask in there. Like, oh, this thing is great.
This poor thing.
So
it's just the weirdest thing. I wring it out and I hold it up till it'll like fall down and get really long and flat. Like, look at this thing. It's crazy.
Yeah, and when you see it, when you do that, it starts to like crawl up itself. Like it tries to like, you know, crawl back up itself a little bit. And
it's like moving around and stuff.
Yeah. After you're all booping around doing that stuff, and can I get from everyone a perception check? Wait, do we have that in this game? I can't fucking remember.
Yeah, we have for that perception skill.
Okay.
Hit me with wisdom.
Wisdom. Your wisdom. Yeah, wisdom would be okay. Oh shit, Garrett Connors.
11.
Connors. I see everything.
Eight. Sweet.
I don't see the...
It's like right up the top there under skills. It's like...
Oh, yeah. I forgot to open the sheet. I found it. This is like...
Yeah.
Perception and what?
Wisdom. So whatever your wisdom modifier score is. Fifteen, all right. And I think we're missing one. Yeah, we don't have yours, Harkin.
No?
No.
Oh, it didn't go through?
No, not by the looks of things.
Oh, okay, let me try it again. I don't know why it doesn't do this.
It should have a pop-up that'll ask you for additional modifier. So maybe if you're not seeing... Seeing that,
you know what? I think there's something wrong. I think I have to reload roll 20.
That's
Give me a second.
Yeah, yeah.
Let me just try one more time. Mm-hmm. And then... Come on. Please.
Please.
Oh! Right, it works.
Cool.
Okay. Well, I'm restarting roll 20 anyways, but yeah. I'm here.
Sure. So, how'd you get a fucking 15? That's crazy town.
I have.
I can't even look at that formula and tell you.
No, hold on.
Yeah, no, I mean.
Do you want to look at that formula?
I'm going to re-roll it because I.
NASA calculations.
I'm super smart.
Round 0.0019145 times 8 times 8 minus 2 times 8.
It's weird when it does that sometimes.
Yeah.
Plus 8. Don't forget the plus
8
at the end.
Oh, plus 8. Wow.
Oh, that's what that was. Okay.
I'm not sure how that
So your modifier would be 0 if it's you.
You probably added zero. your attributes to the modifier.
That'd be a negative 1 actually. Like Actually, anything under 10 is a negative 1, so.
Yeah, just subtract 8 from that. Or do you want me to reroll it?
You can reroll it, it'd be easier. That way I don't have to do math at 2 a.m. in the morning, 3 a.m. in the morning. 7. Yeah, okay, cool. I guess Ratsy or sort of Wilder, actually all of you except for Doc for some reason. Doc, I don't know why you don't hear this, but you notice like there's sort of like an explosion over in the port. And you see a bunch of people just running towards the center of the marketplace now. And, making a whole bunch of screams. And as it turns out, screams sound the same regardless of what fucking language you speak. So,
The Wilhelm scream exists in space.
Yes, it does. You can never get away from that shit. So, we're gonna Wilhelm scream our way into a break real quick, guys. So, those of you who are in the marketplace, I mean, the perception is kind of like a rumbling in the background, you know? The people who went with the translator and Willie and the handler to go get coffee or something suitable. Mm-hmm. You guys are a lot closer, and the rumbling is more of a ground shake.
How is Willie and the Handlers is not a name for a band? I have no idea.
Willie and the Handlers.
I'm so sorry. I swear to God, on your channel, I'm the worst player. I'm so sorry.
It's just like, you know, like,
oh, yeah. God.
That completely wished over my head, man. I'm just like, yeah, Willie and the Handlers. Nothing wrong.
Willie and the Handlers sounds like an Old West, like,
yeah.
So it works. They call him the hand.
Somebody plays the washboard. that kind of music.
Yeah, I imagine good. it's more like the rum bottle type of music. Like they have a guy that specifically plays the bottle. You know, he's like.
Yeah. He's got like three sort of tentacle mouths and three bottles.
Really, and the Handlers are a jug band.
Oh, did one of you guys like redo your camera in the break? Son of a bitch.
I don't think so.
No?
I didn't touch nothing.
I think we're all in the same spots.
I'll never tell.
Alright, we good now. We good now.
Alright, cool.
What are your guys' first reactions to like this explosion that happens?
Oh, crap, what was that?
As soon as I hear it, I'm like, I think someone's playing with some dynamite.
Well, Henley, just so it's clear, when you say there's an explosion, does it sound like dynamite, or does it sound, you know, is this like a sci-fi, does it sound like a fucking electro implosion device, you know, you know what I mean? Like, does this sound like an explosion? We would know it's an explosion, or does it sound like some fucking like, you know, like fucking Transformers having sex kind of sounds.
Electric fog.
You know what I mean?
I know what you mean now. Yeah, that's a good point here. It does sound like a standard like explosion, not some sort of weird like space fire implosion.
Right. Like okay.
Doesn't sound like a Decepticon coming, for example.
Yeah, okay, yeah. All right, that's perfect. That's all I need. That's what I need to know, right? Like, because, like, one would make more sense than the other about how to respond to it, but now we know it's an explosion or whatever.
Yeah.
Okay. If it came from the direction of our ship?
Yeah, from the port area, yeah. No, not necessarily, yeah, like, from your ship region, but, like, from the port area, yeah, specifically.
Okay, yeah, just that general, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we gotta go, let's go make sure our ship's okay.
Yeah.
Oh, shit, that's the only way out of here.
Can't leave the big Willy behind.
What does Willy Everything, I'm sorry to like keep taking the spotlight, what does Willy Everything say? Does he like immediately like say something like, I'm detecting reports from, you know, explosion in quadrant area, blah blah blah, like is he picking up like the emergency station stuff?
Like, I think you're thinking a little too much into like what he actually does.
He doesn't listen to the news.
He doesn't. It's not like For him, it's more like he can hear things further, but it's kind of like a dog. Like, you know, when a dog likes to be laying there all of a sudden, just chilling, and then he'll stick his head up and just like look around. It's kind of a little like that for him.
Dogs fucking crazy when you think about it, though? Like, dogs are literally, I'm going to sleep all day, and then there's like, they see something, and they're like, I'm prepared to die for you. And then they go back to sleep. Like, that's their life, right?
That's it's
like,
their life. Time to die. That is a dog's life.
No, and it's just sleeping. Like, they just go to being preparing to die, like, for whatever. Like, they will fight to whatever. And then, otherwise, they just go to sleep. And it's like, they're like, out and then just ignore it again.
Yeah.
Like, that's their life.
Yeah, I guess that makes sense.
It's fucking like here or there. Like, that's it. It's amazing. Isn't it weird?
Yeah, they're lying.
Right, I don't know. I'm sorry. I think about this a lot. I'm sorry.
We should.
I mean, my mind has just been completely blown. All right. Like, the world.
Have you read a comic book called Rover Red Charlie?
No, but it sounds like something about dogs in the Vietnam War and makes me really sad.
No, it's not. It's like. If it's the basically the apocalypse, but from the eyes of three dogs, Rover, Red, and Charlie.
Oh, okay, that sounds pretty cool.
It is. It's really good, and like they don't understand why their masters are all of a sudden going fucking batshit crazy. But like, it's definitely a really cool comic book, and we should make a role playing game out of it. That's all I'm saying. D&D with D&D.
Have
with
you heard puppies. Of a game called The Warren? You can play rabbits in that scenario real easy.
Yeah, but fuck rabbits. And like. Anyway,
that's what they do.
Ooh. What? Sorry. Anyway,
you know, I mean, I'm gonna go in the direction of the ship. But I tell everybody that who's with me, we should come along. Like, let's go down.
All right. What are the people in the Wilda and Garrett doing?
Yeah, I'm coming along.
All right, but you guys aren't together, so I mean, all you guys here are like a rumbling in the background, and. If anything, an onslaught of people running towards you is more loud than the actual explosion itself.
Oh, huh.
So you're distance away, so.
Huh. What are those people are running from? You have an idea?
Well, it sounded like that explosion. Let's go. I don't think I'm with you, actually.
But. No, it's just you and Wilda, so.
Renzi, I think he's talking to you.
Yeah, I'm just...
your too, chat. Too busy trying on... Too busy
and
trying
I have
on.
A cookie. No, I... so, I do have, like, a bunch of, like, clothes and stuff like that. Some pretty cloth and stuff that I found. And... I might have pocketed one of the little critters that I saw while no one was looking because of the explosion, and now I'll just be like, yeah, let's go back and make sure that everything is okay with the ship.
Yeah, definitely.
No worries. I mean, the only person who didn't, like, for example, if both of you failed your perception check,
right? Yeah,
it would have been a different story, but you definitely know that there is something happening within the port, and if your first concern is, well, that ship is our well-being, then so be it. Let's.
Yeah, without it, we're...
You're kind of stuck here, you know?
Right, yeah.
So definitely,
yeah, we're definitely...
You guys head on back, but for you guys, it's a little harder because you have to fight against a wave of people going in the opposite direction.
Yeah? Oh, yeah, so just waves of aliens rushing at us.
Yeah. So how do you two want to get through this? I mean, if you have, like, athletics or maybe you want to navigate through, like, buildings, like, is there anything here that you guys want to try and do to circumnavigate this stuff? Otherwise, it's just going to take time, right? You can get
do
through...
Do you have the power to move things?
I can kind of lift things. I can't really do much with it right now. Just kind of, like, if I wanted to, like, lift this but, like, not touch it, I could do that.
Right. So can I suggest to him that he tries his crazy magic on the people to get them out of our way so we can get back to the ship?
That's a lot of magic.
Yeah.
So you have some power points that you can use on this. And what is a level one ability of
Level one's just remote manipulation.
So that's like firing a gun, basically.
I can basically use my hands away from things. It has an effective strength of 10.
So from what I remember,
you can, like, knock off a guy's hat.
Basically move little objects with my mind.
From what I remember, it's like you can use your remote manipulation means that you can use your hands effectively at a distance that you can't normally reach.
Yeah, the stronger ones let me actually like shove things and like do stuff. But like right now I can just use my hands from a distance essentially. Yeah. So I probably I'll try it. And I walk up and I like shove somebody with my mind and they just kind of like get knocked back and then just run around me or something.
Yeah. Like maybe they were like not even paying attention and kind of they just ran into something.
That didn't work so well.
I like how you can like just like psychically Heisman Trophy your way.
Yeah.
Like mostly move people. I don't know. I guess I'll resort to just cheer force and start pushing people out of the way.
I mean, so what type of skills do you have? I mean, for example, you can use athletics to jump around people. You can
have a little in athletics.
You can use navigation
to
climb up onto a building and run on top of it. You could use perception to see if you can find a shortcut that's not being used before. Or you can use something like, you know, maybe you can use persuasion to shout really loudly to say, it's safer over there, and, like, direct people. But, you know, they probably wouldn't understand you, so, like, you know, you tell me what you'd like to do. Otherwise, I mean, you can make your way through without rolling. It's just going to take time, right? Yeah. So
my initial rolls were pretty terrible. I don't really have much for skills. I have athletics and persuade.
Okay.
Survival. But
I think just looking at the wave of people, I look to Wilden just like, should we just push our way through?
Yeah.
Oh my god. Okay. Alright. That's fucking ridiculous.
Wow, that's exactly how I picture this.
That is amazing.
So, in case you're wondering, anyone who's playing at home, we are literally looking at a picture of all the characters, basically cowboys with literally just Chris Pratt's face on every single one. Bonnie Clyde from, Anna Bonnie? I don't know. The lady from Black Sails.
Bonnie from Black Sails.
Yeah, and like, that's cool. That's cool.
That's great.
GG. GG. Anyway.
That is awesome.
Yep.
I think we're going to try athletics.
All right. I mean, if you want, we can do one athletics roll and the other person can help. So the way that it'll work is whoever's helping, you have to pass the same athletics check.
Yeah.
But if you pass, then the person will get a +1 on their athletics check to do the main check, right? So who's helping and who's actually attempting?
Excuse me for that. I think Wilda said she was shoving people out of the way first, so I feel like
sure, I can help. I'll assist.
Yeah, she should be taking the point.
Okay, so why don't you, Tux, roll me, or Garrett, roll me a athletics check real quick. All right, good. So Wilda, when you roll your athletics check, it'll be strength plus your athletics +1. So whatever your athletics score is, just add a +1.
There's actually, when you click the skill thing, there's actually something that says assisted, and you can click.
Okay. Oh, really?
So I've, my strength, I've got a +2 on there as well.
That's right, yeah. So you put that as your modifier, yeah. Oh, nice.
I did that right.
That's good. 12 is great, yeah. 12 is like, you know, you're just like, maybe you're just walking down the middle of the road and all these people are running towards you and you're literally just like palm on face or whatever the alien equivalent of the face is and just pushing them out the way. And Maybe, Garrett, you're following behind her, and maybe you're just sort of, like... Occasionally, someone will run, like, around Wilda and, like, trying to get in your way. You just sort of, like, maybe shoulder budge him or whatever, shoulder check him.
Yeah, I got, like, if she's doing the main shoving, I'm getting kind of the stragglers. Like, someone, like, bursts out of the crowd, and it's like, oh, no, 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 yep. Oh, no, no,
yeah.
That way, over yeah. here, nope.
A lot of them are Homo sapiens, so, you know, they're not so bad to push around. Plus, it's worth pointing out, too, that you guys are fucking, like, throwing these guys like ragdolls. Like, they were running.
We were, like, kind of barely touching them, but they still just, like, shoved us to the side.
Yeah.
Like,
oh, my leg!
Yeah. Sorry.
Yeah, you're, like, literally, like, breaking bones on them and stuff like that, too. So, like, yeah. But, you know, you make your way through this crowd. Team Golden Retriever, which is the other guys, you guys come to the port where you were before, and, what you see is essentially, like, a bunch of, like, ships just forcing their way into, like, the port and blowing up ships that were in sort of, like, docking bays before yours. Have you guys ever played Mass Effect and they have that, like, those docking bays where the Normandy will come in and just sort of sit there?
Yeah.
It's a little like that, right? It kind of looks like sail ship docking bays as well, right? So, you know, they'll have, like, a...
Never seen it.
You ever seen it? No. So, it's fine.
I've never played Mass Effect. It's okay, me neither.
Fix that!
I do 2 stars in those games.
You son of a bitch.
Yeah.
Don't tell anyone.
The first game is really boring, though, so, you know. Whatever. Anyway, basically, they're being, like, your ship is sort of, like, in the far side. It's sort of like these guys are sort of plowing into the middle and oh, look at that papa. Oh. And you guys are like, basically you have to make your way across all of this stuff to get to your ship. And what's happening is like these ships are just forcing their way in and they're like literally like driving over the top of other spaceships to get in. Kind of like they're like it's almost like a landing party, right? Like kind of looks a little like Normandy. Except in space. Space normally. So yeah, what's your main thoughts after seeing this? And there is gunfire or laser fire happening down there. You can see it for sure. So it is actually people attacking.
This is literally an invasion?
Uh-huh.
Or a pirate attack. Don't know.
I mean, those are basically the same thing.
Well, no. Well, I mean, there's a... No, the big difference there is scale and scope.
I was joking.
Is it like, is the entire sky like raining fire of these ships coming in right now? Or is it just like right here?
There's a fair few ships, yeah.
You know what I mean? Like I mean, you could tell that it's a difference between like a shooting star and a meteor shower.
Mm-hmm. So the ships that are coming in are like probably one class larger than yours. And they're sending these little ships out of them.
Basically. Yeah, like drop pod shuttle down, right? Mm-hmm. Oh, shit.
We have, like, some Battlestar Galactica level stuff here. With the camera angles even, yeah?
Now, these are still shots. They're definitely not shaking shots, so... The audience can actually see what's happening. And you guys have been, you know, trained by, like, you know, Jackie Chan and John Woo and stuff for, like... You know, you're good. Like, we're doing it. We're doing it old school style. We're doing it John Woo style. You know, like everything is like brilliantly filmed. None of this fucking Transformers bullshit. Michael Bay, go fuck yourself. So, yeah. What's your first thought, Mike?
I think my first thought is holy.
Yeah, this morning you guys like, catch up to like maybe like the first team is so gobsmacked that
you know you've never sort of run up an invasion like this.
Yeah, you sort of run up and you know Wilda's clutching onto like fucking I don't know 35 dresses or something like that, and you know her little pouch like
whatever that thing is that I stole.
It's just sort of like moving around like going. Blah, 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 blah. It's probably like pooping in your pocket or whatever, but that doesn't matter.
Nothing like, you know, Nothing I haven't had experience with before on the farm.
You don't have poos in your pocket? Come on.
Yeah, many critters pooping in your pocket.
You know a little country song, poo in my pocket?
Yeah, little critters.
Garrett, do you still have your slinky?
Yeah, I'm like holding it like once we get there, just like looking around like if it starts leaking out of my arm, I'll like move it around a little bit to make sure.
Like if it's trying to like leak and escape.
I like the idea that you've tugged your shirt in, you put it in your shirt. You just like, it's just, like hanging in there like a baby.
I don't know what to do with it. I'll just put it in here.
It's literally flubber. You have flubber.
So yeah, William everywhere will be standing next to you. And maybe like the handler. Well, the handler from, Team Golden Retriever would have come. I don't know why I'm calling you guys. Team Poppers.
Run with it,
yeah. So, you know, he's there as well, and he will say something to William Everywhere, and William will turn around and say, it would appear. What fucking voice was that, Dave?
Elkin says, of the country.
Hello, I am a gentleman. No, he will, well, y'all, seems like the Falad have caught up to us.
Oh, man.
You mean them ants?
No, sir, that was a sugoi.
Wasn't the Falad those little things?
I think Falad are those gators.
Yeah, the gators. There you go, Mr. Hartman.
Oh, no.
Yeah, big old lizard dude.
And Vlad at Tanagra.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, right. Them gators that walked on two legs. Gotcha.
Yeah, we saw them in that picture thing that Will showed us.
That's right.
There's some here, too. Are they like... These are the good ones? Those are the bad ones?
But I thought it was them ants that was chasing us.
There are more than one. Wait, fuck, I really can't remember his fucking voice. It's annoying the shit out of me.
He went with a southern accent.
Yeah,
it was, yeah.
There are certainly a lot more.
Yeah,
that. Bad guys in this universe than just one. As far as the Homo sapiens are concerned, the Falad are the biggest threat.
Well, I reckon that's a problem, but there's one, two, three, a lot of Falad up there.
William Everett sort of looks up and reads, and he adjusts his hat, you know, and he just like the lens sort of moves around, and he's like, by my calculations, we're probably dealing with maybe a couple thousand Falad right now.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, that's a lot.
That looks like a lot. Is this normal?
To see so many? Probably not, no.
I would like my weapons back now.
I mean, you already have them. Like, the moment you left the thing.
Okay.
Oh, we grabbed them out of the check on the way.
Yeah.
Okay.
What? Is this like a raid or something?
It would seem that we're being assaulted. Yes.
Well, that ain't good.
No, that ain't good at all.
Good observation.
Kind of want to make a run for this ship. Like, go.
Yeah, so if you want to do that, that's perfectly fine. What's the rest of the crew feeling like?
Oh, yeah, no, 100%. I'm with Resin.
I'm trying to ask Willie, do they accept duels, or do we just do firework shows? And I just basically point off at all the lasers flying over our heads. Just think it's fireworks.
I'd probably declare that they would not be very interested in dueling with you fine gentlemen and gentle lady.
And I reckon we better get back to the Big Willy.
Onwards to the Willy. Big one, not the small one.
Oh, that's really cool.
Get on out of here.
Come along, Mr. Everywhere. I reckon we're gonna need you.
So he'll say something to the Homo sapien that's next to him, and then he'll sort of nod, and then he'll look at you guys, and he'll do like a, you know, like hand on the chest sort of thing, and then like sit straight, and then he'll just turn and like briskly run down the road.
Is that? I don't know. We should go. To turn and start heading towards the ship.
Sure. Yeah. So the bay and port are pretty much chock-a-block with Falad. What's your game plan here, guys? Like, how are you gonna circumnavigate this potential political and combat puzzle that I've put before ye?
I turn to the crew, and I go, "All right, folks. These people kind of help us out a bit, and maybe they may need a new sheriff in town. And if we do, there might be some money in it. What do you say? You think of something?"
I reckon, Mr. Graveheart, you'd be a mighty fine sheriff, but I also reckon we might be fish out of water at the moment.
But think about it, Doc. If we might be heroes of this fine place,
do a way to kill a 1,000 gators?
Why not? We do it back at home.
Like at once, though?
Maybe we could just find the biggest gator and they all run away.
Is that how it works?
How often have you wrestled gators?
A few times, Doc.
All right.
Sure, I got bit here and there, but it's not bad.
This deserves a flashback, I think. Yeah. So we're going to explore this a little bit. Tell us, Mr. Graveheart, about the time that you wrestled that one gator and it bit you.
Way back in the day, some of Graveheart's family, they're a bit deranged. They like to keep gators for fun, so they would keep like these pins.
So explain to me where you get
gators for fun.
Yeah, they keep them for fun. So they just keep them. They just breed them.
So does that mean the planet you're from had like water marshes and stuff like that? Like,
yeah. So
on the other like side,
Wild West. It's like Louisiana. Like Louisiana, Texas border. Like, think of that area. Maybe that's kind of what our planet was like. But also makes sense because we had the Caribbean, because we had water ships and pirates. This makes perfect sense.
Mm-hmm.
We had like a Cajun influence. You know what I mean? Like something like that. Like Cajun Mexico, like the whole Gulf of Mexico kind of style. I love that, actually. I'm sorry, I'm talking a lot.
No, it's okay. Let that guy sit.
So tell me about the gators.
You help me with it. No, you're good, though. You're good.
So your family kept gators. And why would you wrestle this dangerous animal for fun? Like, what was happening?
We were really bored a lot, especially like kids. Our family usually sells gators or the eggs or eat them or turns them into purses or clothes. So we just put them like small little pins, grow them up. It's like, but one time, I hope you guys don't hear the barking.
No, we do. Go ahead. Just continue. Yeah. It's fine.
Yeah. All right. Sorry about that. So basically what happens is, one time, like, he's basically hanging out with his cousins while, like, feeding the gators. But one of the gators, they empty all of them out so they can clean it. But one of them was left behind, but they didn't know. So basically what he tells the crew is like, well, I slipped and fell on some poo. I think it was a bird. I can't remember. But once I fell in there, I think I was about 14. It saw me in the water. Looked at me. Because didn't know what to do. So I knew the only thing that I could do, be a man. It came at me. I had a stick. I jumped on top and I jammed my stick right in its eye. I held on it for dear life. I kept just beating the heck out of it in its eye, poking it, whatever I could do. And eventually, it stopped. I kept beating just to make sure. But then, when I ran off of it, it looked at me. I looked at him. He slowly creeped back in the water. I slowly creeped back and grabbed onto my mat and my cousin got onto me. Yep. I was a man that day.
Wow.
And that exact moment when I got out of the pen, my testicles also dropped.
Yes.
Yeah. So, the story fills your guys' ears as you make your way close to the ship. Now, the closer you get, the more you start to see how this is looking. So, you know, they've pretty much got the port, like, locked down at this point. You know, they're making an assembly front. Like they're reassembling their forces at the front line here. And there's a bunch of, you see a bunch of like other aliens that have been captured, I guess, and they're just sort of being lined up, or and they're all laying down on the ground with like their hands tied behind their back. And then there's this one crocodile. He's wearing like, the only way I'm going to describe it is basically their army, the Flad, they're wearing like SS gear. Like they're wearing like that hat that the Nazi SS gears wear, and they're wearing like, yeah, bullshit. And the only way
Hugo Boss designed their alligator. Oh my god, are they wearing gator skin suits?
They're not wearing gator skin. That'd be fucking strange. But
gator and gator.
But you know, have you guys ever
played? No, they're wearing a hat that says "Gator Done."
So, so I don't know what that is. I'm sorry. I'm just gonna ignore it.
Don't worry about it. You missed it.
That's, it's cute, it's
really,
babe.
Just know that's a really funny joke, and it's really funny.
So, okay, I'll believe you. Mostly because I know that you're the world's famous internet vulgaris. So,
internet pop mogul.
Internet pop mogul vulgaris. So the other, and they're wearing like, I don't know what you call it, but have you guys ever played like Persona or whatever before? And they have those high school gear, like, which is literally like the collar, like all the way around. And then like, they got like the, it's like a button up,
You mean a school uniform?
It's kind of like a school uniform, but like it's like
a preparatory academy school uniform.
Yeah, and it's black, and the buttons go across the chest diagonally down, and that's like sort of the uniform that they wear. They wear like these hats, and like the insignia or the rank of you know, the hats have different like basically like insignia and ranks on them. And you they have like little tail fins as well, like on the jackets.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're still sort of wearing like sort of like black leggings as well, and it's sort of weird looking to see it. Like basically they're like green, and they've got like these glowing spots underneath, like on their heads and stuff like that. But their helmets, they don't have helmets; they just have these like hat things, and they're wearing like utility belts as well. And most of them are carrying like laser rifles. But yeah, they're basically assembling a marching force to march onto the front there.
Yeah.
Tried to find something fascist prep school wardrobe. First response was Taylor Swift. Yeah, okay. I'd believe that.
Sure. Yeah.
So, continuing down the path, you guys can sort of, you have to get to the other side of this port, essentially, right? So there's a, mm-hmm. How do you think you're going to get through? Because there's no way that, I mean, you can try, but there's almost like 600 of these guys here. So the port is very big. You could sneak around and you could sneak through it pretty easily. But you might run into the risk of fighting a couple of these guys, and the longer you stay in combat with them, the more likely that they're going to get reinforced. So, what's the thought process here, guys?
Well, everyone, like, do you guys want to try and like sneak around, or maybe I don't know if we could ask Willy to possibly find something that may be explosive or some trap that we trigger that maybe helps stem the tide, or
so you want to try and set up some sort of trap to like stop these guys
or trigger something? Like, you said, like, it's a big port, right? Like, how big's the port? Like, I'm pretty sure like
it's enough to fit like 600 people trying to line up and march on the city.
Okay,
so it's like a huge imagine like the size of your ship holds like easily like 60 people on it, like easily.
With this port, like with the like, if they do trading stuff here, like, could we like maybe ask Whaley like if there's like something experimental or like explosive or something like a trap that we can use that usually may come to the port, like I don't know, something that's coming to like the database or whatever, you can find out or something.
You're asking a lot right now. You're asking like for there to be something just here that you can trigger to kill 600 people.
Well, not just 600. Something that we could do to stem them, like, halt.
Well, you tell me. What would you want there to be here in order to do this?
Is there a way to, like, literally, like, close, like, the doors that they're coming in through? Like,
It's a big open space. It's not, like, inside a building or anything.
Thinking, like, when all the ships on top of each other, I'm thinking, like, the door is, like, that is
Are there red barrels that are clearly explosive?
Yes, and they're standing next to them because they're just like, we can use these as cover when we get into a firefight. Lasers don't pierce barrels.
Ping off. All right, well, never mind. What do you guys want to do? You guys want to sneak by or fight them out? I don't know.
I'm still feeling pretty weak from our fight with those ants, so... If we could, like, not get in a fight, I'd be okay with that.
Yeah, speaking about that too, Sorfang, you would have, like, maybe 3 health at this point. You know, like...
Yeah. Yeah, we're not into fighting.
Yeah, I still kind of want to just try to escape.
That's right.
Yeah, like, we're clearly outnumbered.
So, like, a long way around or something?
Yeah. Yes. You can navigate around. This is sort of like, I don't know if any of you guys have like a stealth skill. Any of you take stealth at all?
I'm at -1.
I did. I have stealth at 0.
Okay.
As do I.
All right. So this would be part navigation, part stealth.
Right? Sneak doctor.
So we're going to make 2 rolls here, and One of you guys can assist the other in the role since it's, you know, the 2 roles going on. So, remember though, every time you fail an assist role, it's not just like, nothing happens, but you're in a dangerous situation now where any failed role could represent capture or like being the guards being alerted or anything like that, so...
So are we all making a roll, or like one of us makes
One of you, like if you want, you can make a roll to assist another player, but I'm only going to accept 1 navigation roll and 1 stealth roll.
Marcus likes to be the leader and can just look at us, so he'll do navigation.
He's awfully good at jumps.
And he's good at jumping.
He can jump.
Okay.
That's a compelling argument right there. Yeah. I'll happily assist you, Eric, if you want.
Now, if you want, if you can get any sort of height, so you can get a better lay of the land, I'll give you a +1 on your navigation here. But you have to put yourself in a position maybe where you'll be spotted. It's up to you whether you want to take that risk.
Is that this mental?
Yeah, I do. I'll do that. Like, I do that for everybody.
Crawling up on someone's shoulders.
Yeah, it'll be like...
Simba them?
Yeah, let me just pull out this cool little pet I got and use it as a lasso to put myself up to a... Yeah.
Marcus, he believes he's seen enough of the city to probably navigate through in the port, so we'll bank on that.
All right, so, sorry, could you repeat that? Your mic's pretty quiet.
Sorry about that. Marcus is pretty settled that he believes that he knows the city well enough after getting here once, so coming through the port and all of that, so he's going to bank on that.
Okay, sure. So who wants to assist Marcus in his navigation check?
Me? I volunteer as tribute.
All right, cool. Yeah.
So is it stealth first? Did you get up to do this stealthily to help?
No, this is, you're assisting in navigation check, so you have to roll navigation.
I know, but I was hoping to... Okay.
You want to help on both?
I was trying to get into a position then to offer better advantage.
Oh, so you want... Yeah, do you want to climb up?
Yeah, I wanted to climb up. Exactly. There's like a building or whatever, right?
Yeah, give me an athletics check. Yeah.
Oh, sure. No problem. Is it okay if I roll with...
Here's the thing. You can climb without athletics, right? You can climb without athletics, but it'll be loud. And athletics is just like you climbing a building quickly.
That's fine. Yeah. I'm going up to the roof to get a better idea of where
to
go.
So you can use strength or dexterity or constitution here as your modifier.
Yeah, I got 4.
What'd you use? Strength, dex?
I use dex.
Dex, okay. So maybe you're like, I got this, guys. And you're like, you do the whole like Assassin's Creed, like jump up a couple things to like get up on the roof, but then you slip and fall on the first one, and it makes a shitload of noise. Like it knocks over a barrel.
Mm-hmm.
So let me roll a dice. Let me roll a dice. Good old D8s. Oh, how I love them. Okay. What would be? I guess maybe like a some sort of perception check or something. Oh no, you're good. Yeah. So maybe like the camera like sort of shows like a couple of guards just being like, but then they just, you know, ignore it for the most part because, you know, there's gonna be noises when you assault a port. Who would have thought? So, yeah. You look real good to everyone, by the way, when you did that.
I know.
It's cool, bro. So what's the so yeah, you can continue to climb if you want. You can take another strike at it.
Yeah, no, I would like to, as long as I'm allowed to.
Can I give him a boost this time?
You want to assist his assist? I don't think I'll go that deep, but yeah, if you want, I guess both of you doing it, you know, you'll make a lot of noise, and see, here's the thing, if you make noise without quickly doing it, you'll force another perception check to see if they can spot you guys.
I'll redact my...
It's fine, I want to get up to the roof, I'm going to hook myself up, I'm going to go again, I'm going to get to the roof, and then hopefully I can help.
Roll it up, Hawken. See that athletics, bruh.
Easy, 5.
Easy, 5. Man, you're rolling trash tonight.
Yeah, man. I got fucking dumpster dice. I haven't turned on. Let me go talk to Suzanne real quick and get her to give me those roll 20 hacks.
Well, lucky for you, I rolled a 3, so you're still good.
He's slightly improved since last attempt, also.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I'm using a barrel not full of monkeys.
That's it.
You can learn.
So, yeah, you can make... I'll let you make one more attempt at this, but then you guys are going
to
move on.
What do I need to roll to succeed?
A 6, bro. It's 2d6. It's the same as it's always been in Stars Without Numbers. You got to get a 7...
No preset difficulty for...
No, you got to get a 7 through 9 to pass, and then a 10 through 12 to pass.
You know that's not actually how the game works, right? You know that's Apocalypse Roll that you're citing, right?
No, it Stars Without Numbers is 2d6.
Yeah, but you roll 2d6 dice, but it's based on a difficulty score based on what you're trying to do. No. It's not actually a resolution system like Apocalypse World.
I can guarantee
everybody runs it that way, but it's actually not like that. Which is why I asked that.
Oh, I just thought it was usually a 7 was like normal difficulty, and then...
It is. Normally around a 7 is about like a, you know, you're really pushing it here. You're acting under fire.
Yeah, that's how I'm running it, though, so...
I'm fine with that. I just had a different... I didn't know that was the expectation, and that's, so I'm sorry for looking like an idiot. I'm sorry.
Well, you might be right there, actually.
Look,
let
there
me
go.
Just
no
double
problem.
Check that. Let me Bam. Just double check that shit. I'm
See,
sorry.
I got Suzanne in the other room. She just called up, you know, some Riley and some other Roll 20 people. She got me hooked
Son
up.
Son of a bitch. All right, yeah, no, you're good now. You sort of... scramble your way up a clay wall or whatever, and you just like you get on top of a building next.
Yeah,
to
it is clay, isn't it?
Yeah,
it's like the bullshit space. Yeah, okay.
It's like we're future tech, but fuck it, man. Yeah. We still like mud huts, like, you know.
The fucking like ecological plastial clay bullshit.
Yeah,
yeah, like totally. Like mm-hmm. Staccata? Is it staccata? Is that what it's called?
Space cement. Yeah.
Oh, what's the
stucco? Not stucco. It's like staccato.
It's a solvent solution that you can get into a container and you mix it with water and you can build a whole building out of
Adobe.
It. It's great.
Oh, it's Adobe. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's right. And, you know, they keep asking for updates and I tell them no. Yeah, totally. Okay.
So, yeah.
I'm up there and I quickly look around. And what do I see from the top of this building as this whole place is getting invaded? So I'm going to make a perception check.
Yeah. No, no, no. Right. I mean, this is you. Yes, yeah, so this would be you rolling an assistance navigation, right? So.
Oh, that's right. I'm assisting. Okay.
So basically, right. if you pass this, which is, oh man, now you've got me thinking about skill checks and shit. Okay.
I don't.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. So starting from six up. Yeah. So that's what I thought. Six up, and yeah, anything under a five is like Bootyville. Okay. Oh wow. I mean, even with that plus one you get from being up top, you still threw it, and you took it, and you just. So I mean, here's what's gonna happen. I'm going to roll another die. And you can come down. You can come down right now, no penalty whatsoever. If you stay up there another round, I'll roll a die, and we'll see if they spot you.
I'm going to stay up here.
You want to stay up here? You want to have another check?
Oh, yeah, I want another check.
All right, you got any stealth checks up there?
No, I'm navigating. I'm helping him navigate.
I know, but... If you don't want to get spotted, let's get it. Sure, you're just standing there being like, "What?"
All right, I got an eight for my stealth check. Sweet. I'm up against like the I'm thinking of the fucking buildings out of BF1, dude.
Yeah. That's what I'm thinking as well. Yeah.
they have that crenulations, I guess is the word. Mm-hmm. Right. I'm like behind one of those, like looking over. I think that's the word, crenulation. Yeah. So anyways,
thinking those houses must be fucking awful if it ever rains, which it probably never does, but the moment it rains, those things must be filled with water. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, no, you're good now. You look over, basically you're looking over these ledges, and for the most part they're all sort of conglomerating in sort of like the bay area of the port, right? So, imagine it like an ocean, and it kind of is on an ocean, which is weird for you guys as well. I don't know if you've ever seen an ocean before. I mean, you've seen lakes. It's kind of like a lake.
Never seen the ocean.
And, these ships are sort of landing in water for the most part, and your ship landed in water. I'm sorry I didn't mention that before, but you're sort of landing in water. So deep and cool with the assist on another assist. Yeah, that's right. You can sort of like go further away from the port and sort of loop around, right? And the chances of you, like, you look over in that direction to the right of where the, like, because I imagine the port's on the left, and then you guys, it would walk around the right side of it. But if you look over the right, there's only like, occasionally you see like a small group of like 2 to 3 of them walking around, basically securing the outside of the port. But other than that, that seems like the safest way to get there. So with that, I guess you crawl down and you tell that information to Marcus. And Marcus, if you want, you can make a navigation roll with a +2.
All right. The cool thing is I already have a +1 navigation, and I got an int of +1 too, so...
Yeah, you're rolling a +4, yeah. No way you can fail this.
Nope.
Cool.
Nice.
Yeah, so basically with the up-to-date information, you decide that it would be a good idea to go now. Now that you know like where they essentially are, and given if you don't make a lot of noise with the next stealth check that you're about to make, you guys should make it over to the ship without any problems. So, who wants to be the stealthy leader of this group? Don't all shake your head at once.
I will.
I'll do it. Oh, I was going to say that. All right.
All right, Mr. fucking Doc Sullivan. How do you suggest, like, how do you lead the group? Or, like, maybe there's a situation where, like, I imagine it's a case of, like, you're getting closer and closer to, like, an actual patrol, and you sort of take the lead on this in the situation. Like, How do you stealth past these guys without them noticing you?
So Doc basically is using Mr. Graveheart, using Mr. Graveheart's information. Doc is going to try and basically lead us from bush to bush, essentially. Or...
So you, I mean, I imagine that maybe as part of the information you got was, you know, how long they sort of spend before they, you know, their loops coalesce, I guess, for the most part, because they're on a patrol, essentially. So maybe you can use that as part of your stealth check. Like, you know that you're coming into a region where their loops are, and maybe your stealth has been, you've been keeping track in your mind as to where they would be specifically on this loop right now. Because you have no way of knowing where they are right now, but given the information that...
I can time it.
That Harkins, or maybe you're timing it in your mind or something like that. So if you want to go ahead and make a stealth check with a plus one, that'd be great.
With,
Yeah, probably intelligence in this intelligence. One. Yeah, it'd probably be intelligence because you're actually timing it in your mind, so...
And a plus
one, plus one, you said? Yes. Mm-hmm. Boom. Hey, look at that. So yeah, it is what you imagine. Like, you maybe you're rounding a corner and like everyone's sort of like, it does that Scooby-Doo thing where, like, you know, we get it from the perspective of over the shoulder of these Falad, and you see these silhouettes like run past like a street or something like that, and then the moment like the last of you gets to the safety of cover, like they just sort of turn around and start walking down the street you just ran past. So you guys do that a couple more times, and you know, with the lead of Doc Sullivan and his mind's eye, you manage to get through the situation without alerting any of the Falad whatsoever. Congratulations.
We did it, guys.
Now you just need to fly a ship out of like a heavily contested port.
I'm sure it'll be fine.
Yeah.
Can I do a thing? When we're like Absolutely. Stuffing through and like we like pass by and like one of them kind of comes like gets kind of close, but he looks away at the last moment. Can I touch his mind and see what his emotions are?
Ooh. Read out exactly what your power says to do.
User may determine the current emotions and any especially strong emotionally charged surface thoughts on the subject. The target makes a mental effect saving throw to prevent the mind reading. On a successful save, the psychic gains only an impression of their current emotions.
All right, so how much PP does that cost you? Is this one?
One.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Interesting. So we need to roll a d20. And they have a saving throw of 15. Okay. Was that they had to get... Is the saving throw they have to get over or under?
Over.
It's over, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
So lower is better. Okay, yeah. So what happened? You get what exactly when they fail?
Read the exact thing again.
Yeah, sorry.
Current emotions and any especially strong emotionally charged surface thoughts.
I'm wondering if, like, this is the type of thing where it, like, translates. Because it's, like, psychic powers. Like, what are you thinking? Do you want to set a precedent here? Like,
when I use it on Doc, I got, like, images, kind of?
Yeah, but he passed.
Oh, okay. So I guess it would just be like, if he passed, I would probably just get like angry or sad or
yeah,
like,
but you'd get, like, you'd get like
a, I'll get the impression of it kind of.
You'd get like a color or something like that, or a smell or a taste.
Yeah.
But he failed, so he has to give you like his surface thoughts. But I'm wondering if like his thoughts would be in his language. I'm wondering if like. Probably. What I'm asking you is, we can set a precedent here where your psychic powers can.
Well, there is actually a psychic power to allow me to understand things. So I guess I'm okay with it not translating with the lower level power. That would make sense to me. And like maybe later on,
I'll tell you what. We'll set a precedent here. If you master this ability, then yeah, you can translate.
Okay. Cool. Yeah. That makes sense. Yeah. So now I just kind of get like it. Now it's just impressions and like language I don't understand. When I master it, I'll be better at translating it to my own. Okay, cool.
So you get a very, very hate-filled like literal, like malice dripping sort of impression.
Oh yeah, so I probably like shiver, like feel creepy right now.
So, and maybe you even get like, yeah, maybe even get an impression of just like, this guy has killed before,
mm-hmm.
and he wants that thrill again, and he's literally like,
out for blood.
Yeah, he's like almost blue balling himself essentially with like how much he's building up the anticipation of just fucking killing someone, right?
Oh god, yeah.
Like his malice is insanely high. He's just he's literally thinking about like what it's gonna be like to bite into their flesh. Like you're getting like imagery, and you're getting like you're getting like an like sort of like a. What's the word? Like you know how someone like you're getting a narration of his thoughts at the same time, but you can't understand them. But what you're getting is you're getting just malice, and you're getting like the sensation of biting someone. Like you can actually feel your jaws like clenching.
You can taste the blood in your mouth.
I know. Yeah. I'm like I probably like stop and like
adrenaline. Right?
Yeah, I feel really terrible. And I really wish I didn't have these powers.
So what? How does
your muscles like tighten? Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Like, you feel your heart in, like you feel all of that.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe it's like a little. Can you give me a mental effect save, actually?
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Just got it.
Just got it. So like maybe you're like it's one of those things where you can feel like his malice sort of come like. You can feel yourself being swept up into his like thought mm-hmm. process and malice and stuff, and you have to literally like peel yourself away from this thought to just come back, because maybe you like if anyone saw your face right now, it'd be scrunched up and you'd be very like you'd have a very angry look to you. Like, do you look into this guy's eyes? Like, how do you touch minds with this guy? Like, exactly.
I think still at the moment it's pretty accidental. So like. I assume like when we're like sneaking around, Doc's like, okay, move, and I like look to see, because I'm looking around to see, and like I like look at one of them as they're like walking past like around a corner or whatever, and I just kind of like focus on them a little too long, and like since I don't really have control over it yet, it just kind of triggers and just happens.
Maybe his malice was so intense that you just sort of like...
especially because like right now they're so intent on finding somebody to kill. Hmm. It just like I felt it like fringely, and then I was like, I wonder what that is, and then I reach out and like, oh crap.
Yeah.
It just like took me over for a second.
I'm interested to know what your thought, Garrett's thought process is when he sort of gets pulled into this sort of pool of emotion.
Yeah, like, so, like, for a second, I felt that anger and just, like, pissed off about stuff, and then I was able to peel myself out of it, and now I'm probably just scared.
It's less...
The fact that my brain was almost taken away from me for a second there.
It's less that, and maybe you think back to, like, William Everywhere telling you about, like, how people actually have to take medication for this stuff.
Yeah, yeah. Like, the weight of this is like kind of like sinking down on me now. Like, oh shit, this is really freaky.
Hmm.
I like open my eyes, like I'm like wipe sweat from my brow and.
Oh yeah, no, you're like you broke out in a cold sweat like almost.
Yeah, yeah. I look up and they're like the whole group's like already like 20 feet away from me. Like, oh shit, and, like I have to hurry up and get back to them. And
yeah, yeah. So yeah. You guys make your way over to Big Willie, pretty uneventfully as it is right now. You get on there. No one seems to like pay attention to like the stuff that's happening behind them, right? So you guys are like on the opposite end of the port now, and you can make it safely inside of the ship.
Volume went out.
What?
Yeah, it got crackly, and then I don't hear you, Henley.
Hello?
Hello.
Hello, where's me you're looking for?
We've lost our DM.
I'm still here.
Yeah, he's definitely talking, but nothing coming through.
Or is he like a space master?
Space
master, yes.
Space master.
Yeah.
Hello. Henley, he is.
Why won't you talk? You're really creeping us out.
do you guys want to like lip sync for him?
Oh, hey guys, my name is Henley, and I'm.
All right, shut up, nerds.
Oh, okay. Jesus Christ. I was about to start making clucking noises, but okay.
I was going to play booty for the next 30 minutes.
Booty.
Booty, booty everywhere. Yeah. So let's all take booty. A drink. So yeah, you guys get onto this onto Big Willy, and you manage to sort of like start the procedure to take off. Well, you know, with the help of William, you manage to get the starter procedure to take off. So William will sort of turn around and be like, "Y'all think it's a really good idea to leave people like this? Right now, the Falad have the ability to mentally destroy everyone in the Homo sapien race."
Well, I reckon that sounds mighty terrible.
Well, Willy, I would like to fight. How do we go about it? And like, I look at the rest of the crew. I'm always down for a good fight.
But only I don't think seven versus a couple thousand is a good fight.
Well, we got Big Willy.
I reckon you might be able to wrestle one of them Gator or Falad, but I reckon you can't wrestle a thousand at the same time.
Yeah, I don't want to fight them.
So, yeah, you get at this point, Garrett, you've just instantly reminded of just the pure malice again. Like, it's still sitting in your mind, and it's just like, you can't shake it.
Even just the memory of it is like, I probably like shake again and just like, I want to get out of here.
So I guess I'm a little bit torn because coming from a family of, well, generations of slavers, I don't really care so much that like a bunch of these guys are going to turn into mindless alien zombies because like we had a whole farm full. They're pretty useful. But at the same time, I don't feel good about leaving all of the Gator Nazis to just take over like that. That's where I'm at. Kind of like I care, but I'm not supposed to care, but I still care. Can we just like take a step back in the ship and take a look at the situation? Like we have the ship. Does Willie maybe have any suggestions? I mean, there was a lot of military stuff on the ship.
So Willy will sort of like think for a moment and then he'll turn to you and say, "Well, we do have a lot of ship-based weaponry we could use on the troops amassing on the port. The only problem I have with that is that we're going to make ourselves a target for any of the other spaceships that are around."
Do they not have any security on this planet?
Look, the last thing you want to do is take a fight on someone else's terms.
So, they do have security. In fact, they have a lot of security. But for some reason, the Falad have still managed to come and easily board and easily, like, mount this assault with little to no resistance.
Yeah.
Is this like the main home planet of all the people or something, or like?
Yeah, yes. This is in fact the home planet of the Homo sapiens. Well, at least where the largest contingency of them is.
Huh. Well. Yeah. That's a shame.
Marcus doesn't like the fact that it's some people that are in danger, but he can't help them because he may be a scumbag, but he's got a little bit of honor. It's just he wants to help those.
He's a dick with a heart of gold. Yeah.
Yep. The gold dick. There you go, Henley. Good job, man. But yeah, he likes to defend those that can't defend themselves. He's just like, must be a way. That's why he's like trying to talk to Willie and the rest of the crew. Just like, there must be a way. Or we could be a distraction, leak them all for a goose chase. Who knows?
Well, I mean, I want to help people too, like really badly, but like we're hopelessly outnumbered.
Yeah.
Like, that's how I see it. Like, there would be no... I'd rather get revenge, right? Striking at them when we have the advantage. But, like, we're on the back foot. Like, they sucker punched this planet, and now it's like...
Yeah.
We don't know what we're up against.
It kind of just showed up, and now they're just taking it by force. It's kind of weird how easy they're doing it as well.
Yeah, I don't know what we're supposed to do, but I don't really want to stay here any longer.
Yeah, can we just like say fuck it and jump?
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah. Can I decide that for everyone since I'm at the controls?
I mean, yeah, you're the pilot. You can definitely just fly out of here.
Yeah.
I don't know how to do the jumping thing that Marcus does, though.
We need Graveheart to jump for us.
Yeah, I need him to do that jump he does before I can
do
anything.
You won't be able to jump into hyperspace from here. That's for sure. You need to get out of the atmosphere and into space before you can make a jump safely. But, you know, who knows what happens between then and now, so. Why don't you guys think on it, and we'll take a quick break, yeah? Jumped onto Big Willy, and you have a couple of decisions to make. You could, leave these guys for broke, get out of here, make your living on the wilds, or you could stay back and fight the Nazi menace that is the Flood. Or maybe a combination. Pizza Hut really and Taco Bell, you know, like...
So we're all basically like in like the whole like piloting room and all this stuff.
The sitting room.
Yeah, the sitting room.
The sitting room. I'm all for getting the hell out of Dodge.
Thank you, Mr. Connors. It's like, well, folks, you guys want to take this to a vote? And I'm basically like sitting at the control console to whatever the hell to do, since Willy taught me a bit how to work it.
Mm-hmm.
So you,
to help them, or we run?
Ready to do that? They're jumping.
But I am,
jump around. Yeah.
Even though,
so I'll have to remind you guys, you have to leave the atmosphere before you can make a jump.
Yeah. We have to pilot up
and out. Yeah. But yeah. So, do you guys want to take a vote on this, or like, how do you want to handle it?
So, what kind of weapons does the ship have? Like, since the time we spent with you, or like when I asked whether to teach me. Like,
yeah, yeah. So you would know that your ship has access to. It has a multifocal laser, which is like a single shot, like single target sort of thing. And it also has a sand thrower, which is like a flat cannon. Now, a sand thrower is mostly used to attack like fighter jets and stuff like that, like small craft that would like harass your craft. And the multifocal laser is mostly used for like piercing hulls and stuff like that of bigger ships. But having said that, the sand thrower is actually really good at dealing with troops around your ship as well too. So if you're being like boarded from the outside, or you know, you want to deal with ground targets and stuff like that, you have to get reasonably close. But the sand thrower, basically, just imagine like what it's doing is, it's now imagine if like It shoots like little shards of like.
It's like flechette, kind of.
Yeah. I was about to say tinsel, like, but tinsel's like them. Yeah, just thousands of them. Yeah.
Yeah,
death by a thousand cuts, sort of thing. But like.
Yeah.
There you go.
But moving a lot faster and would also hurt. It's... Yeah.
FPP.
So you could effectively do like a strafing run on these guys and hit them with the sand thrower. But I don't think any of you guys have any abilities to like gunnery, right?
Mm.
Actually, no. One of you does have gunnery, I'm pretty sure.
I don't need guns.
No. Combat gunnery is what you need. It was available for you guys to take. William has a zero in it, so he can shoot a gun.
I'm a negative one.
I didn't take it.
I think we are better. I reckon it's best for us just to get out of Dodge.
Yeah, I don't want to stay here anymore.
I just asked Willie, what are our odds?
He just turns to look at you and he's like, do I look like a computer to you?
What's that? What's that, Willie?
A calculator?
Like
a device that does mathematics.
Like an abacus.
He doesn't look nothing like an abacus.
There you go.
Oh, I think we just found the title for the episode.
It doesn't look nothing like an abacus.
Nothing like an
abacus. I didn't see that one coming. All right.
Looks like somebody took apart a whole bunch of guns and glued them back together wrong.
What I want to ask you was like, so this is a shit ton of ships in the sky, but all of them mostly emptied out like on the ground, whatever the hell's.
Yeah. So it's say like basically they have one sort of like not as big as the carrier ship you saw before, but. They have a frigate.
The ships are bigger than ours, right?
Well, they have one frigate in like above, sort of like in like outside of the atmosphere. And they sent down a lot of like frigates with people. So a frigate, you guys have a frigate class ship. And frigates can range between like, you know, any size, but small frigates is what they sent down. You guys can hold like 60 people in yours.
They got one ship as big as ours and then little small other ships.
No. The little small ships are about the same size as your ship.
Okay, that's right.
And they have one big ship that all these little ships came out of, so. Starships, here we go. Yeah. So you're looking at about patrol boats, which, they're frigates. So, you know, they hold about 40 people, roughly. So there's a lot, they're dumping a lot of frigates. And they have a bulk freighter as their cruiser ship that's cruiser size. It's definitely not capital size. But it's mostly just empty space. And you'd imagine that... Yeah, so that's essentially what's happening right there. So,
all right. So all the crew want a dip potato chip.
Dip potato chip. Yeah, I know what you're saying.
Yeah. No, like that's the way to do it.
All right, so we're bouncing. That's what we're doing.
Boom. I look at Willie and I'm like, I'm sorry.
We're gonna fucking fly through a fucking invasion force. Also to get out of here?
Not really. Yeah. I mean, like, you can... Like
we have to fly out before we can jump. So we literally have to fly kind of like right by him before we can do anything.
So that won't be too hard at all. That'll mostly just be one piloting check from one Will DeFerris.
Boy.
Can you please give me a vehicle space check? With, what do you want, like strength, dexterity?
Strength
would be good. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I mean, that's like you manhandling the ship. So you're not a very elegant pilot. You just sort of I imagine like the ship would have like some sort of like lock or whatever that it does. It's kind of like, you know, how you drive a car and it has like power steering and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like if you took that car and then took away the power steering, and then it's you having to fight against the machine in order to drive it.
Okay. That's like, I've never driven a clutch before.
It's a lot, not so much that clutch is more like a mechanism, but like there's a big difference. Like you'll know the difference. And anyone who's driven a car without power steering, and it's pretty hard to find a car these days without it. It's kind of like aim assist in first person shooters, right? Mm-hmm. On one hand, you're doing it very manually. On the other hand, like you're having help by like systems.
Yeah.
So your type of driving is, you know, you're sort of like pushing the thing to the limit, and maybe you like instinctively found a switch or something like that that allows you to go like just turn that, like it, something was beeping and you're like, what the fuck is that? And you like push a button or something like that, where you push a bunch of buttons and it stops beeping. But what that effectively does is it turns the ship piloting assist off, which means that it's like now, like when you pull the stick in a certain direction, you feel the ship like groaning against like how hard you're pulling it in one direction. But what that essentially means is that you can do very technical maneuvers a lot better because you're fighting against the actual the ship itself and pushing it to its absolute limit.
Okay.
So yeah, you just roll your vehicle space.
Yep.
Which I believe is a negative one for you, and then add your strength modifier to it. Yeah.
Do it. Do it now.
I'm doing it.
Doing it and doing it and doing it well.
That was two, right? I'm a two?
Yeah. It'll be like it'll have like a modifier thing in there, so.
Yeah, the assisted, and then just two.
Yeah. Or. Let me just double check. I'll roll it real quick, because I'm not sure. Ian. You pick your attribute. Yeah, just pick your attribute.
Mm-hmm.
And then assisted, and you're at zero. So yeah, don't worry.
Zero. About. Okay. Yeah. All right.
Ooh, that's not good. okay. So yeah. So you basically you got to do this, and maybe like you weren't aware of this, but you go to like launch off, and like you feel the ship pulling against the earth, and you have like a warning light, and it's just like meh, 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 and you sort of like, maybe William will come after and say, it would appear that we have been latched onto by the floor or the dock. We will probably need to land and remove that first before we can do anything. It's kind of like you guys have been chained to the ground.
Can we just shoot it out or something?
Can we just cut it off like we do when we sell out the horses and everything we're tying up?
Yeah, but we'll need to land first.
Mr. Everywhere, I was not in the Navy. But as I understand it, in order for a ship to set sail, you need to weigh anchor. Did we forget to pull our anchor up?
Essentially, yes. But well, we never did. We never. Using your metaphor, sir, we never actually put an anchor in the first place. Someone else put this anchor down when we were away. So we need to actually go outside, take off this hook, and then we can make our way out. So what do you do, Retzi? Do you just keep trying to fly away with it hooked on, or do you like land? Like, what are you trying to do?
Yeah, I don't know. Can Willy help me find the button that puts the anchor back?
No, what I'm saying is your ship has been tied physically to the ground. Like someone has come along.
Yeah, this isn't our anchor. Like someone else put something on us that's left.
I see. Yeah. Can I try to leave harder?
You will probably break the ship, most likely.
So. Yeah.
Worth it?
Worth?
I don't know. I'm kidding.
I mean, in case you haven't met me before, I'm kind of reckless with stuff.
We all saw the video.
Will, yeah. Willie, can you go outside the ship and get rid of whatever that is?
Certainly I can attempt to do it.
All right. Go sever that line.
You're going to have to land first, though. So do you put it back down? I mean, it's not hard. You just sort of, like, just reel it back in. Yeah, definitely. So Willie will, like, he'll grab, like, a laser rifle and he'll head outside. So if none of you are going to go help him, we're going to make a series of rolls.
I'm going to go out with him.
You're going to go out?
Yeah, I'll be like, I'll go with you, Willie. I still owe you one. You saved my life.
Okay. So he's going to take, like, he takes a laser rifle and he slings it on his back, but he also brings, like, sort of like a, it's a plasma torch, but you guys never seen this before. It sort of looks like a, like a handheld, like, fire dispenser. Like, yeah.
Is it like a weird black can and then, like, a gun attached to it or something?
Yeah, yeah. Sort of looks like how it looks these days. So, Willie and, Marcus, you head out. Let me see. I'll make a quick roll here. Okay, yeah. So, your piloting has also drawn the ire of a passing patrol of Fallon. So as you land and you open up the bay doors, the door comes down and you start to walk out. Can you give me just real quick, Marcus, a perception check, please? Using your dexterity. Okay, yeah. So basically what happens is the moment you start walking down, you get fucking hand soloed by stormtroopers. And they start firing on the drawbridge. And you basically, with your perception, you have enough roll, enough of a dodge to get out of the way before, you notice it and you basically roll. So do you want to roll back into the ship and take cover, or where do you want to go? Because you can go out and take cover as well.
I'm gonna go out and take cover.
Yeah, okay.
Not with Willie. Or is Willie, like, ahead of me, or is he, like, behind me?
So he rolled as well, but he's gonna head straight for the hook underneath the ship.
Yeah, I'll follow right after him with the nearest cover.
Okay, sure. So you're gonna give him covering fire, essentially, while these guys are rolling on deep?
Yep.
Alright, so does anyone else want to help outside, or?
I'm just going to stay put in the sitting room.
Okay. Anyone else?
No, I wanted to help.
Cool. You can help very easily. So if I could get...
as long as we're cool with me helping Marcus. Marcus, you cool with getting some help, buddy?
Well, Mr. Harkins, it'd be an honor. You got your guns, right?
Yep.
Okay.
All right, let's do this. Let's go.
You guys are basically, So essentially what happens is, you roll me a turn order stuff. Initiative. Let's go. 1d8 plus your dexterity. Or you can just click the initiative button.
Damn.
Seven.
Okay.
Nice.
Did you want to join them, Tux?
Nope. I'm probably sitting in one of the chairs, like, rocking a little bit.
No. Okay.
This is bad.
I was freaked the fuck out.
Mm-hmm. 1d8 plus 2. Okay. All right. So. Marcus, you're up first. You roll out of the ship, and you slam into some sort of like cement pillar or something similar like that behind these guys. So, your shield bubble, like, you know, you turn it on and you get like the familiar sort of like closed oxygen circulation thing going on. And it ripples in front of you a little bit, and then it sort of disappears from your vision. What are you doing?
So they basically like see me and winning, they just opening fire on us, right?
Yeah, they already took their shots for the last round, so.
Okay. Well, I'll take out my pistol and I'm gonna take a shot at one.
Sure. So for this guy, you need to roll your combat. What class are you?
I'm an expert.
An expert? Okay. So you don't have any attack bonus yet. So rolling, you would be rolling a plus 5 on the AC.
Okay.
You're using revolver, yeah?
Yeah, I'm using my revolver.
Okay, cool. Oh, so yeah. Sure. Take a shot. Again, it pierces through the bubble that these guys have around them. And it sort of just like skirts around like their uniform. And it's sort of just like, it's sort of like it hits the uniform, and then it sort of just gets dragged across the surface and flicks, like just sort of rolls around him and then gets flicked off to the side. For Lad's turn. So both of them sort of like, when they see you guys coming out, they both, have you ever heard like a dog whistle before?
Mm-hmm. No.
No, you can't hear it.
No,
but you hear the sound, yeah, of like the guy, yeah, being like, you know, so you hear that, like, you still hear the sound of the whistle being blown, but you don't hear what they hear, right? So just for the sake of, so these guys emit like a high sort of dog whistle like sound. They sort of direct it directly at you. But nothing seems to happen. Like, you just hear the sound. It's kind of annoying. It's just kind of like, you know, like this weird sort of screeching. But give me a perception check, both of you, actually, please. Just real quickly.
Assistant, right?
Oh, yep, no, that's good. So basically, like, maybe you hear like the, like, to your left down the side there, like, maybe there's like some, there, like, out of a window falls like two Homo sapiens, and they start rolling around on the ground and just screaming like super loud. And they're both like clawing at their ears and eyes and stuff, and they're just like, ah! And like, you can basically see like just like blood just start appearing like in, like, around their eyes and nose and ears.
This is
and stuff.
What they did to our ship.
There we go. But you guys seem completely unaffected by this for some strange plot-driven reason.
Weird.
Weird, right? How is that a thing? That's super weird.
I'm totally gonna go up and try to help those guys whatever I can, like first aid.
First thing?
I tell Marcus to give me cover as I go to like help.
Oh, them. You would have to run past the flad to get to them. They're like imagine this.
I got you.
So imagine a situation where like,
oh, okay,
you're like just coming out of the ship, and there's like some houses on the dock behind them. And when they hear the screeching, a guy literally like falls out of a two-story building and just like starts crawling around on the ground, just like screaming, and blood just like starts coming out of every orifice that he has.
Let's shoot these dudes.
What was that? You gonna shoot him?
Well, yeah, I have to go get them, and the fucking alligator guys are in the way. Are in the way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's your turn, Hawkins. Yeah.
Yeah. So all right, I'm gonna fire my rifle. What's the AC input value? I should be.
What are you using? Laser or?
Oh, non-laser. Just my old, good old rifle.
Oh, you have a rifle? Fuck, I had no idea.
Yeah. Well, we got back to the ship, so like I was able to have my rifle. Yeah.
Oh, is this the mag
rifle?
That's
why I was like, helping Marcus. This is why I want to help Marcus, because I have my rifle.
Okay, yeah. So is this a rifle you took from your home planet, or is this the mag rifle?
Yeah. No. This is a rifle I took from my home.
Cool. Yeah. So it's the same. AC is 5.
This is my bounty hunting rifle.
Yeah.
6.
AC 5. Yeah.
5. Sorry. Thank you. No other modifiers.
Well, your combat plus your attribute.
I know, but I guess the input value factors all that in. I don't know. Well.
It does it? Do you? Wow. There you go. So do you have you're a warrior, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, so you would have so that makes sense.
Skill is 1.
Yeah, so your dex is 1, your combat projectiles is 1, I assume.
Yeah.
And then you have your, why do you have a plus 5? Oh, that's from the AC, yep.
Yeah, AC.
And then, so you're rolling at a plus 4, so you have your two modifiers, and then you have your attack bonus, and then you have where'd the other plus 1 come from? Anyway, it doesn't matter. You fucking nail it. You hit the thing, yeah. And you fucking 10 damage. Holy shit, dude! That's crazy. That's a lot of damage. What? So what is it? Like a lever action? What is it like?
Okay. Oh, it's a lever action. Does this like when you fucking Princess Mononoke like shoot his arm off thing?
Yeah. Oh, that's cool. Yeah.
So, amazing reference.
I saw it not that long ago. I fucking love that shit.
So. Okay. So, the first guy, you basically just like, where do you shoot this guy?
And then I told you I shoot his like, he's probably like got his gun or something like that, or like he's like reloading it, or like he's or maybe he has a sword or something. I don't know, like whatever he's armed with. I like whatever has the weapon in it. I literally shoot from like upper shoulder, off, like down to his hand, like it's off. It just flies off.
Nasty. Okay. Yeah. So yeah, you shoot this guy, and
just fucking, like freaks out and like falls over.
This purple, basically it goes, it like pops the bubble again. And it like maybe lands in his shoulder or something like that, and it this purple artillery blood just goes like coming out of it, and he just sort of like he stops his screeching, but the other guy is still screeching, he just like grabs the wound, he just starts fucking like, you know,
is he still alive?
He's still alive, yeah.
Motherfucker. All right.
Willie's gonna like plasma torch this hook, man. He's just going to town on this thing. So, you guys, unless you like lean over and look, you hear the like the sound of like a torch being lit, like the, you know, the and then the sparks come up and the torch comes, it's like, and then he like gets basically, it's like there's like a big fucking magnet like just hooked onto the bottom of the thing, and it would take a lot longer to like find the code to unmagnetize this thing than it would to just cut the hook or the restraints that's holding it to the ground. So he's like at the base of the magnet, just like hook, that's cutting, it's kind of like a padlock, right? You could try and break the padlock part, or you could just snip the fucking the loop. Yep. And he's snipping the loop, right? That's what he's doing right now. So Marcus, you're up, brother.
Alright. Well, I'm covering Harkin.
Yeah, sure. You gonna take another shot? You gonna shoot the one that was just shot, or which one are you shooting at?
The one that just got shot.
Alright, cool.
So is that thing plus 5, right?
Yeah, plus 5, yep. Damn, dude.
Fuck.
Yeah, you rolled a 1. Yeah, of course you fucked up that. You don't have any projectile skills?
I do, but it's like a 0 and I got like 1 dex.
Okay, that's cool. Yeah. You got 1 dex. You sure your gun's set up correctly? Because you're rolling at a plus 5 and nothing else.
Shit, I'm hitting the weapons button too.
But did you select the dex as like the modifier?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's weird. Yeah.
Anyway, so yeah, you take another shot, but this time you just completely like miss, and maybe like you're too distracted by something, and you shoot the ground in front of the Phalad. All right, so now these guys are just one of them is going to keep up the screeching, because but the other one, he's going to take a shot at. I guess he'd take a shot at you, Harkin, because you shot him. So.
Well,
fuck that guy. Yeah, fuck that guy. He's gonna pull up his mag rifle, and he's just gonna launch a bullet at you, brother. AC-7?
Yeah, unless there's any, like, circumstantial, like, cover I could use.
No, you got AC-2, because you got your bubble.
Yeah, we got the
bubble. Oh, that's right, the bubble, I forgot. Thank you so much, holy shit. I knew, I was like, well, I don't remember being this weak, but that's what my sheet says.
But, you'd also be behind cover. Like, there's no way you wouldn't, you wouldn't just be standing out in the middle of, So, 1d20 plus 2 plus 1. Alright, that was close. Yeah, so he... This fucking hot lead just, like, whizzes past your head and maybe, like, bounces off the back of the ship or something like that. The other Phalad, like, he gets, like, he leans deeper into his, like, screech. He's just, like, his mouth is, like, a gape. And you can see his, like, tongue just, like, rolling around in his mouth while he's doing this. Harkins, so... Time to lever action or lever action?
I like lever.
I like lever actions. Lever actions are fun to shoot.
Lever. All right. So, firing the rifle again.
Go, go, go.
Do the thing. Oh.
No, not good. So yeah, maybe the whizzing metal over your head is just enough to like just like sort of make you duck a little deeper into cover, giving you like worse aim on your next shot. Willie's gonna make. So basically he's just gonna keep cutting, and he turns back and says, y'all keep him busy, it's gonna take a little bit longer. Marcus, what up, dude?
Shit, I had like a C in my head, but that's probably not good. I wish it was like a crane or something, and I guess I'll take a shot at that same dude.
Go for it.
Yeah, I don't know why, but the sheet's kind of weird, but like it's not adding all the other stuff, so I guess I'll just...
What other stuff do you need to add? You don't have an attack modifier, you have your dex.
I just have my dex, yeah, but it doesn't add the plus one. But...
Let me take a look at your sheet.
So would I just roll d20 plus 6 then?
What? No, let's see, so you got projectile weapons at 0, that's fine. You got dex modifier at 1.
So plus 6 then, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So roll
5. So just roll that button, see if it rolls it again. Just click it for me.
Okay.
Do it now.
Do it now.
Crap.
Damn. Right. Eric, you passed me your curse, bro.
Sorry, man.
It's all right. Just kill.
RNG must be balanced.
Okay, pants. So yeah, the Flad's gonna take another turn. The guy with the mag rifle is going to take another shot. He's gonna continue firing at you, Harkin. Since you're the one that fucking busted his shoulder up.
makes sense.
Oh, getting closer. Yeah, like his aim is getting better and better, and it's like, you know, maybe you had like your hand like on the thing, and then you like you see him fire, and you move your hand, and like the bullet like hits where your hand was, sort of thing. So
dialing it in. Crap. Fuck, I'm just getting worse. Shit.
Yeah, he's getting closer and closer. You're getting more antsy, man.
One of those hacks.
Yeah. Right. So you can hear something drop now, from behind Willy. But he's still like something heavy that fucking just hits the ground. Yeah, he's still not done. He still needs to, do something down there. Marcus, you're up, brother.
All right. How many shots did I already do? Jeebus.
It's like three right now. Yeah. This would be your fourth one. Yeah.
Fourth time, right?
Yeah, go for it.
Just one. Just one.
Just one, please.
Oh.
Oh, my fucking... God.
Yeah, you guys are getting shaken up by these dudes, man. What's going on? Yeah.
Oh, can I? Is there a point where I get tired of seeing this from the sitting room and?
Yeah, maybe there's like some sort of camera that you're looking through or whatever, and you're just like. Oh.
Maybe I should go help them instead of sitting here. I was thinking about like, you know, we might need to do a quick escape or something, but at this point, I think I kind of want to go help.
Sure, if you want to go help, you can. Roll me an initiative. There's just a button under common rolls there. Okay. So yeah, you'd go after Willy then.
What?
Yeah, you'd be the last in this turn, so. So the flat are gonna take another shot. 16, and the other one is going to take a shot as well. Okay, yeah. So basically, like a bit of metal, like flings, like just, you know, flings over your head again, Harkin. Now the other one pulls out like his sidearm and starts taking a couple of shots. Except this one's a pistol, so. Yeah, a bunch of laser fire like rings over your head, Marcus. No problems. You guys are pretty safe behind this piece of chunk. Harkins, you're up, brother. Hey,
damn.
No luck. Willy, he's. You hear the torch like turn off, and he like runs back around. He's like. Unless your boys are enjoying yourself, you should probably get back on the ship and we should get out of here now.
I guess, because I can't roll anything higher than an 8, so.
Hey man, you did a pretty good shot the first roll. You got like almost 30. Wilder, like you see William start coming back onto the ship now. And he's like, basically he just turns to you and says, we're free of the restraint, we're good to go.
All right, so I'm just going to start running back towards the sitting room then, yeah. If everyone's coming back onto the ship.
All right, Marcus, you're up. What are you doing? You can move and shoot. You can shoot and move, so.
So do I see Harkin, is he still, like, shooting him, trying to hit risky to people? Like, what's happening?
Now he's pretty much right next to you. Like.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I look at Harkin and I go, you still want to save those folk and then get on the ship? Because... I'm okay with trying to save those folk before we get off this damn piece of shit place.
So if you take a look over there, they're pretty dead. Yeah, like there is more blood on the ground than it should be.
Okay.
I mean, you're not a doctor, you know Doc Sullivan, but you like to think that life fluids like blood and stuff needs to stay inside of people.
I reckon I do.
Yeah. Okay.
I do remember him telling me that one time.
Hmm. Alright. I basically just tell Harkin that we're getting out of here, so I'm gonna run and pop a shot back.
Okay. Throw it up.
And
the pop pop popping to stainless steel.
What are you rolling, miss?
What's that? 15s forever? Okay. Damn. Yeah, so
you've literally been rolling the same roll.
Yeah.
Like 14, 14, 15, 15. Fuck.
Yeah, so you guys all just keep exploding your bullets. You take a run as you shoot, and obviously you miss, but that's not the intention of what you were trying to do. So, yeah. Vlad, take another shot. They're going to both like swing around and try and shoot. Marcus as he runs up to the gangplank. So get an extra one. Oh. Okay, yeah. Yeah, they both take shots at you as you run up the gangplank there, Marcus. But you know you're too quick and you're too slippery, and you make it through. Yeah. What are you doing, Hawkins?
I'm gonna do the same and taking a shot at him while I run in.
Yep. Hey, no dingling. Yeah. As it turns out, combat in Stars Without Numbers is pretty tough.
Fuck that 5% bullshit.
Yeah, man, it's rough. Yeah.
Fucking universal distribution.
Yeah, which is why warriors are like super powerful in this game, because getting that extra attack bonus is like it makes a huge difference. Like it really does, especially at level 2 or 3, you get like a +3 on your attack bonus, and you can literally just mow down people. It's great. So you guys get in, and maybe when you roll up, Harkin, you hit the button, whatever, that closes the door behind you, and you hear the distinct sound of metal smashing against the back of the thing, as well as like laser fire. But let's head on over to Wilder, who you jump into the seat. What do? You gun that shit?
Yep, I'm gonna do exactly what I did the first time.
This is like when we get on the fucking Millennium Falcon.
Yeah,
I immediately thought of like Poe and Finn trying to escape.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
No plan, just run.
Mm-hmm. Just go.
Space. Here we go.
Let's see it. Hey, that's better. There you go.
Yeah.
You fucking make like a tree and get the fuck out of there. So anyone else who's not in a seat, can you please make for me a physical effect save?
All right. I gun it and then be like, hang on to something.
Yeah.
After.
I'm guessing that would be Marcus and Harkin.
Yeah, that we're not in seats, so.
Yeah.
Sorry. Oh, wait. Yeah, hey, aren't you really?
So I imagine what happens here is, like, Marcus, you're on your way to go get a seat, and Harkin, you're literally against the back wall when this happens, so... For you, it's an easier brace, but Marcus, yeah, you basically fall flat on your ass, and you roll me a 1d2 real quick. This is how much butt damage you take. Hey, one butt damage. All right. Mark that down.
Oh, a little butt hurt.
Oh, my ass. That's a hole in my head.
My head ass. Yeah, so, you guys, you fly out of this place pretty easily. Like, your ship is small enough where they, like, the capital ship that's on the outside of this planet doesn't really pay attention to you. So you're pretty good to just, like, make a navigation check and bounce out of there. So why don't we do that, and that will be the final roll of this episode, yeah, Marcus?
All right.
Yeah.
I'll do it, because I, like, rub both my ass and head, and, like, Willie's, like, stroller right next to me. I make the navigation roll. Hold on.
Don't fuck it up.
I saw it looking at him like, so, Willie, you're an advocate. Oh,
you're getting better with your navigation.
Where do you want to head? Where are we heading?
Let me look at it. I gotta look at a short range grid, right?
Yeah, so you can look at the sector map, like this one. You can go one space in any direction from Baktava.
So we're at 505, we're at Baktava, right?
Yes.
Okay, let's go to Sweda.
Sweda it is, 506. So yeah, we see the last shot of this episode we get is Big Willy just sort of like disappearing into like nothingness as it jumps, and the credits roll, and you know the first 5 spaces on the credits is all Chris Pratt, as it turns out.
Yep.
So guys,
space.
Yeah. That's pretty much a show right there. Let's go around and do some shout outs. Up first we have the booty master himself, the king and queen of internet pop culture, Eric Vulgaris.
Hey everybody, I'm Eric. I'm Eric Vulgaris on the internet lands. Some may
know America's me. Eric Vulgaris.
So similar to Henley, I just got sponsored the President of the United States. I'm a tabletop streamer. I stream a lot of tabletop games, a lot of like indie stuff. I've been playing a lot of Torchbearer, which is basically like the Les Paul of like D&D dungeon crawly games. It's really heavy, really solid sound. And it's like fucking, I don't know.
It's slapping a watermelon sound, yeah? It's like the...
Yeah. What?
Yeah.
It's like the... Yeah. So anyways, it's a lot of fun. I'm doing two games of that. Then I also play John Harper's Blades in the Dark. That game's fun as shit. And then I'm also really excited to finally get back to some Burning Wheel this weekend. My Kingmaker, like Adventure Path E-inspired game. So that's a lot of fun as well.
You know, for some reason, I just got into my head. I'm just like, I really want to play a game of Robinson Crusoe with Eric at some point. He seems like the type of guy that would really like a hardcore... I would do that
in Burning Wheel. It'd be fucking awesome.
Yeah.
Cool. Can I tell you a story about that?
Yeah, go ahead.
This is a story John told me. So he was playing a game. They were playing Colonial Boston Burning Wheel. And when they were playing Burning Wheel, it's winter, right? And the entire game was like, listen, guys, winter's going to be fucking awful. You're going to need to make this impossibly high test. So you're going to be spending all of your time basically like doing things so you can get dice for this final test in winter, right? And it comes winter. They don't have enough dice. And they're like, okay, well, you guys are starting to freeze and shit like that. And they have to make a fire starting test. And they're like, well, like, how do we make a fire test? And like the one guy's religious, right? And it's a type of game when you as a religious character with the only copy of the Bible have to go ask your DM, hey, can my Bible count as supplies for a fire starting test? You know, and it's like, fuck, you know, that kind of thing to stay alive.
That's awesome.
It's like that kind of shit. I don't know. I really like it. So I love these kind of weird games that exist out there. Doing that kind of stuff. I'm in a podcast with Tux Radamus. That's going to be coming up soon. I'm still doing editing of those episodes and stuff like that. But if you want to follow along and the progress of that, hit up my Twitter at Once Upon Cast. That's like Once Upon a Cast without an A. That's where all that stuff's going to be. And you can find me at Eric Vulgaris, everything else.
Sweet.
You guys, it was a lot of fun. I like shooting people, even though I was missing a lot. This was a cool episode. Sorry for sometimes being distracting and being a nerd.
It's all good. It's all good.
You're good.
Yeah, it's all good. I mean, fuck, I was doing skill rolls wrong the entire time. So I was like, eh. Anyway, not a big deal. Speaking about doing skill rolls wrong, let's go over to Retsy Reaver.
You would.
Yeah.
I'm great at doing it badly.
Savage.
Look, I could learn easily enough. It's just a button, but that would break character. So, you know.
Yep.
Effort.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm Retsy Reaver. I stream on Twitch a little bit. What did I call it at the beginning? I like to do a lot of infinite survival alphas.
Running
infinite
survival. Yeah.
2,000 pick a year. And,
I've made more picks than I've made fucking money, you know? How many trees have you punched in your life? Oh, man, I can't even tell you.
I punch trees in games that you don't even need to punch a tree in.
Yeah, that's it. It's like first thing you do, punch a tree, man.
Yeah, it's wonderful. It's you know what the defining factor in a survival alpha is for me is whether you can take your pants off or not. If you can't, like I almost quit H1Z1 for real because I was like, awesome, cool game, bro. And then they implemented the ability to take off your pants and I played it for like 300 hours.
That's fucking game of the year.
Yeah, right? Shred your pants, make like a face mask out of it and run around and be like, no pants is friendly. I've probably said it 1,000 times. It applies to real life as well.
No pants.
Ask anybody. Pants or no pants? They're going to say no pants.
No, I love that shit. I love the concept of being dropped in a new world and you have no way to really communicate with people, so you come up with these conventions and knowing that not wearing pants means you're friendly.
I swear you'll make the shoot on site people stall for just like a second. They'll have to stop and think about it. This guy's got no pants.
Look at my crotch.
Every time.
That's true.
And aside from that, I do play a lot of like
are there shoot on site people like, are there diseases in this game? Is that person have a disease?
Yeah. It's like us. when we found the aliens that had no ears. We didn't care about the brown goop all over the ground and what the hell was going on with the cubes inside of the cubes. They have no ears. What even?
What is
they could have been ambushed by something else that killed them in that period of time. But no, we were stuck on the fact that they had no ears and pants. They had no pants. Right? Just so, yeah.
Is a onesie technically pants? Or is it a onesie?
It's a onesie.
It is a onesie. So it is not like, pants.
Is it classified as like?
It is classified as all one word, no pants.
Okay.
It's a onesie. So
you wear pants over the top of the onesie. Okay, yeah. It's like it's underwear for the entire body.
You know? No pants.
At least it's not a mankini.
What was that, Jim?
Theoretically possible to wear pants.
Why would you wear pants with the onesie? That would defeat the whole point of the no pants.
Well. For an alpha, if they just make like a proper Canadian simulator alpha survival, infinite alpha survival game, sorry. We do put pants on over our onesies.
That's what's great about games like D&D. You can always take your pants off.
Well, yeah, I mean, just. That's
why I play.
Yeah.
Nobody.
I mean, nobody.
Nobody screams in.
Pants on this whole time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's very awkward when we go on the breaks because everyone stands up and is like, that's a penis. Yeah. Like,
especially me. They won't let me turn off the camera.
Yeah, it moves the camera around, so we have to see Retsy Rita's penis all the time. It's very weird.
Oh, well, that's shocking. And right, so.
Wow.
Also, indie games, and I usually stream Fridays sometimes, Saturdays sometimes. That's my schedule. Check Twitter.
Sweet.
Speaking of what, Henley? Get the attention off of me, please.
speaking of the no pants dance, let's go on over to Sawfang, my brother from another mother. How many pairs of pants do you technically own? Do you own... Okay, this is a question for everyone. Do you own more pants than you own shirts, or do you own more shirts than you own pants?
More shirts.
Shirts.
I reckon I'm pretty close.
More shirts than pants.
So here's the thing.
No, I own like 6 pairs of pants.
Yeah. So all my pants made it to Poland. All my shirts didn't. So I'm in this weird situation where I have more pants than I have shirts.
That is weird.
So anyway, tell me about your pants, Sawfang. Let's go.
Yeah, I got about like 4 pants. Many cuts of pants. You find my pants also on Twitch. Pants is also on Twitter.
Nice.
Also, sore pants. I mean, I don't know where I can just pull one of these out real quick, but yeah, that's about it. Sometimes I go without no pants for about 3 years. I've been having a lot of pants for about 3 years on Twitch and everything. Yeah, buddy. Also, run pants RPGs and D&D all the like on the weekends. That's all for you guys.
Pants the RPG.
Do you like my pants?
Speaking of foreign language.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Sometimes it is pretty hard to understand Sawfang, but that's okay. We know, we get the gist.
I talk pretty fast, I go crazy.
Crap.
Sorry. I'm Sawfang. I stream on Twitch. Been up about 3 years straight. Heading into my 4th year. I do D&Ds, RPGs on the weekends. I lead an unofficial street group, but also my own little community called The Brosade. And we have a good time. And thanks for, you know, chilling around. And also, you goddamn motherfucker, you rigged your decks to hit me. I hate your ass.
Wow. I don't know if I should be offended or if I should be offended for you. Like, I'm not sure where I sit on that one.
I'm Asian. I am allowed to have diplomatic immunity. Okay?
I can be racist to my own people.
Is that how it works?
Huh. Yes. I'm Asian. I'm allowed to do this.
I didn't know that. I'm white.
I'm white.
Well,
white.
This is why we can have nice things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks, guys.
No worries.
Scumbag Marcus.
Scumbag Martinus. speaking about the biggest scumbag I know, let's blame Tuxedomus for this next pun. Tuxie, what's up, man?
Hey everybody, I'm Chris Pratt. I'm in a movie like Magnificent Seven, Jurassic World. You might have saw me on Parks and Recreation. We just finished up filming on Guardians of the Galaxy 2, so look out for that when it comes out.
Oh, sweet.
It'll be great.
tell me about like your weight loss regime. I want to know what that is. Tell me about that. You used to be a chubby dude, and now you're like
a bunch of trees.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. That is how it works.
Get stranded in some sort of like survival environment, exactly. And then like
you take off your pants, you just run around hitting people with hammers and crap, and then you can not wear shirts in public. It's great.
Chris Pratt as Tux in Linux Land. That's the new title.
Hey everybody, I'm Tuxedramus. I do game stuff like all these lovely people at Tuxedramus on Twitch, Tuxedramus on Twitter, Tuxedramus on YouTube. I'm everywhere and nowhere. I'm here. I'm on other people's channels. I do stuff on my own channel. I'm going to be doing more of my own stuff once I figure out what I want to do with it. And yeah, that's about it for me. Thank you, everybody, for playing. This was a really good time, as always.
Mm-hmm.
And I look forward to next week.
Sweet. And last but not least, we have me. No, we have we have Jim. Jimmy, what's up, man? Fill us in. What's going on?
I'm Jim. Jimtopia on Twitter and Twitch, though I don't really stream. And I don't exist, so I'm going to pass it today. To which way is he to me on the stream, damn it?
I'm like right over the other corner.
Over there.
Over somewhere. I don't exist.
They're okay. This way.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's right there.
Yeah. So thanks everyone for watching. Hope you enjoyed tonight's game, especially you, Chris Pratt. I know you're watching. So if you haven't already, please consider hitting that follow button, whether you're watching on YouTube or on SoundCloud. They also have respectable follow buttons. Sometimes they're called subscribe, sometimes they're called follow, and other times they're called follow. So let me wrap a little bit. We've got a couple new things going on. The first thing I want to talk about is... you know, I'm super excited about it. I'm going to say it again. I have a new partnership with none other than new Retrowave. They make fucking, like, the best synth 80s music ever. They're going to be the official theme music. Yeah, premium shit. It's they're going to be the theme music for Night City going forward. It's going to be fucking great. It literally fits perfectly. Like, I couldn't have asked for a better fit. And those guys are great. You should definitely go check that shit out. They're literally everywhere, YouTube and SoundCloud and Bandcamp and all that shit. The other thing I want to talk about is we have two new things going on. The first is we have a Steam community going up. It's called Life Partners. Where basically, aww. Yeah, everyone can come hang out, because the reason I'm making it is because my Steam friends list is filled up and I don't want to buy into the Steam bullshit of like being a card shark.
Welcome to the 300 plus club.
Yeah, it's real fucking frustrating.
I've been there for a while.
Yeah.
people, like, yeah.
Yeah. So I'm gonna drop that link in here. It's especially. Good. It's open to anyone to join, so make sure you join up and come hang out with us in the stuff that we're going to be doing on that. I don't know what we're going to use it for, aside from just like amassing dudes. It's my favorite thing to do ever.
Nothing wrong with piling on dudes, dude.
Yeah,
it's a lot of dudes, man.
The next thing I want to talk about is we have a brand new show running at the moment called. It is called Board Games with Bearded Bros, where we literally play board games together using Tabletop Simulator. And that shit's a fucking riot. We did Epic Spell Wars of the Battle Wizards Rumble at Castle Tentakill last night. And I had to roleplay a cat wizard.
I need to ask you to do the voice.
Listen, I'm a cat. And I got the perfect spell that I'm going to cast right now.
Why don't you use that voice every fucking goddamn day of every
time? Yeah, like, listen, motherfucker, I don't really want you to come down on me like this, because I only got 9 lives and I ain't got time for any of your shit.
Well, now we need a cat person.
I made a bitch, goddamn it.
I mean, Cowboy Bebop.
Can I get like a physical description of what you look like?
Sure, wear a top hat. I got an umbrella. It's fucking adorable. It's got like a duck head on it. And I wear like this little tiny vest. It's great. I'm also white. Like white as the sun. You know?
Are you like the smush face cat?
Yeah.
Are you like, yeah?
Yeah, I got big eyes. I also am really neutered as well. Like, we talked about my testicles for like the longest time. It was really awkward.
So yeah, that was fun. And that's gonna go up on Wednesdays at 5 p.m. Central Eastern Standard Time. And that shit's good. You can find the recording of that on the YouTube. Let's talk about Die Party for a second. We got four games we run here on Die Party. The first one is Cyberpunk. It's Die Party Night City on Mondays at 5 p.m. PST. That game is going super strong. I love DMing that game. It's fucking awesome. Sorry, being the referee for that game. Fucking Jesus, 80s. It's like the 80s in the future if... It's basically Akira. It's Akira. It's fucking Akira. That's all you need to know. And on Tuesdays, we have a new game called Carrion Company, which started yesterday for the first time. We had our first episode this week, and it's great. That is a fucking great show. I'm surprised at how great it was. We had a giant face-off against a knight, and it was fun. It was fun. It was good. Then we have on Wednesdays at 5 p.m. PST, we have Iron Saddle, which is the show that you just saw here with all these sexy people. And then on Thursdays at 5 p.m. PST, we have Die Party Fulcrum, which is a superhero game that killed Tuxedramus' hopes at ever becoming a popular GM on Twitch. I'm sorry, I just... we beat him. We marveled his DC, you know? Or is it the other way around? No, Marvel's the good one, right? I can't fucking tell anymore. So that's pretty much it, guys. Thank you very much for watching. We'll be back next week with more of this stuff. Our crew have literally passed the tutorial zone now, so they're going to be open and going anywhere they want. And that's what I'm going to do after the show ends. Go anywhere I want. Bye-bye!
Except outside, of course.
Ha ha.